बढ़िया सर, बढ़िया। Yes, hello guys, welcome on Yourpedia platform. I hope you all are fine, preparing well. Very good morning to all of you. So as you all know guys, we are discussing, we are solving some important questions for CSL Cochin Shipyard Limited. Yesterday also we discussed some 40 questions, and again on the same line we are going to discuss 40 questions today from thermodynamics and application. Okay, refrigeration, heat transfer, basic thermodynamics, ice engine question, you are going to find out in this particular class. Okay, so let's start our discussion guys. Okay, so I'm putting here question, all question in front of you, but one by one. It's my request to all of you guys, if you are watching this lecture, if you are watching this video, please try to respond in the comment section so that you will be able to check like whether you are thinking right or wrong. Okay, or you can write somewhere. Okay, you can write, at least you need to check like whether you are getting the answer or not in the time frame required. Okay, you know, accuracy and time both matters. 60 question you need to solve in 60 minutes and you are going to get 60 marks only for that entire paper. Okay, so I feel the cutoff will be always like for this examination, it is going to more than 50 only. So for general category, more than 80-85%. Okay, so, and yes, good thing is what, there is no negative marking in this particular examination, so you can take risk also. So let's start a discussion. So I'm putting guys here question number one in front of you. This is question number one. Let me zoom it for you. So there are two gases. There are two gases, gas A and gas B, with the molecular weight 28 and 48. Okay, with the 28 and 48. What is the molecular 28 gas ka hota hai? This is actually nitrogen ka hota hai. 44 gas ka hota hai? It is for carbon dioxide. Okay, it is for carbon dioxide. So two gases A and B with molecular weight 28 and 44 respectively expand to constant pressure through the same temperature range. The temperature range is same, guys. These two gases, they are expanding at constant pressure. Okay, with the same temperature ranges, means temperature change is same for both the gases. The ratio of quantity of the work done by A and B, what is the ratio of work done by A divided by work done by B? This ratio he is asking you. Okay, what is the ratio of this work done by A by B? How you will answer, guys? This is a very simple question and you can easily get this answer. Sir, work for a closed system reversible is integration PdV. Okay, in differential form we can write this dW is equal to PdV. Okay, dW equal to PdV. So if pressure is constant, you can write this P is a pressure constant. Okay, in this process it is given the pressure is constant. Okay, so in this case you can write this as P into dV also. Okay, something like this, directly P into dV here also, because what is dV? dV is the change in volume, but this is not given to us. What is given? The change in temperature and the process is constant pressure. So how to get the answer? You know guys, for ideal gas, PV equal to MRT. Okay, or here you can write V equal to MRT by P. Yes or no? So if you are not getting any, you can say link, then you can replace this dV. Yes or no? How? Like if you will here differentiate both sides considering the pressure constant, what you can write it here? Kya likh sakte ho yahan pe? MRP into dT. Yes or no? Okay, so dV we can replace by MR by P into dT. So this quantity, if you will put it here, you can write work equal to P into MR by P into dT, or simply you can write work equal to MR dT. Are you getting the idea, guys? So this work you can write it as MR dT. Yes or no? Not visible. Let me check. Why it is not visible? What is the problem, guys? Let me check. I think now it is visible, guys. Yes or no? Please confirm. Is it visible now? Just a second, guys. We are working. Let me check. What is the problem? okay, I think now it is fine. Yes, good, 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 good. चलिए, बच्चों ने ही suggest कर दिया and it's good thing, है ना? चलिए, I think now it is visible. Yes, good, good, good. Okay, good, good, guys. Thank you. चलिए. Okay, guys, fine. So, guys, in this question, he has given you two gases. One gas which is having molecular weight 28, another gas which is having molecular weight 44. He's saying if these gases are expanded with at constant pressure, okay, with equal amount of temperature changes, what will be the ratio of the work obtained? WA by WB. Okay. So, chaliye, good. So, you know, this work, we can write it as integration PdV. Constant pressure, we can write it as PdV. So, dV, we can replace by MRP, MR by P into dT. So, if you'll put this value here, work, we can write it as MR dT. Okay. So, as if you want to write here, the WA by WB. Okay. WA divided by WB. So, this will be what, guys? MRA dT divided by MRB dT. Yes or no? Okay. MRA dT divided by MRB dT. So, as it is given, the temperature change is same for both the gases. Both gases, they are undergoing into same temperature changes. And as it is not given about mass, so we can consider masses are same. So, only this is actually a PSU question. So, you need to think something like that, ki sir, why that data is not given? It happened actually. Okay. So, this masses are same. So, what we can say, work obtained by WA by WB, that is equal to RA by RB. Okay. RA by RB. Okay. And this you can write it as universal gas constant divided by molecular weight of A into universal gas constant divided by molecular weight of B. Yes or no? What is RA and RB? RA and RB are the characteristic gas constant. Okay. And what is characteristic gas constant? Characteristic gas constant is nothing but universal gas constant divided by molecular weight of the gas. Okay. What is universal gas constant? It is 8.314 kilojoule per kilomole Kelvin or 8.314 joule per mole Kelvin. That will be same for all the gases. That's why it is known as universal gas constant. So this will cancel out. So work is actually reciprocal of MB by MA. So this WA by WB will be nothing but 44 by 28, or you can write it as 11 by what? Isko 4 pe bhejoge to 11 by 7. Okay, so 11 by 7 means option B is the right answer for this question. Okay, option B will be the right answer. Very good, guys. Okay, chaliye. Just a second. Okay, so guys, let's move to the next question. This is second question. मेरे ख्याल से मैं background सबके लिए एक ही रख देता हूँ. Okay, fine. So this is another question, guys, in front of you. The most suitable refrigerant for a commercial ice plant. Okay. The most suitable refrigerant for commercial ice plant. Yes. Can you answer, guys? Can you answer this question? Most suitable refrigerant for a ice plant. Okay. Ice plant cold storage. Ice plant or cold storage in all these. Okay, in this commercial system, we use ammonia a lot. Why? Because ammonia is a very good refrigerant. Ammonia is having very high latent heat of vaporization. Jo latent heat of vaporization hai, it is very high for ammonia. And also, for ammonia, the horsepower required per ton of the refrigeration. Horsepower required per ton of the refrigeration is very less. What it means? It means W compressor is very less. WC is very less. For per ton of the refrigeration produced, compressor work is required is very less in case of this ammonia. Okay. But and other than these latent heat, high latent heat and this W compressor, you know, ammonia is a toxic gas. Okay. But it is environment friendly. You know, in our atmospheric gases also, there is low, there is a huge amount of percentages there for this ammonia. So this is not, this is actually a, easily, it, you can say break. Okay. When it reach into the atmosphere, it is not going to cause any kind of global warming or ozone gas depletion. So for ammonia, global warming potential and for ammonia, global warming potential and ozone gas depletion. Okay. Both are zero because it easily disintegrate after reaching into the atmosphere. It easily disintegrate. Okay, let me change the brightness, guys. I think I don't know what is the problem. The question to white mein hi hai. Next time I will try to change the question background also, you know, but this time I cannot change this, at least question background I cannot change this time. Hello. Hello. Okay. Okay, let me turn off some lights. Okay, guys, so sorry for interruption. Yes. I think now it is visible. Yes. Okay, Vinod, thank you. So, guys, ammonia we use in our cold storage plant, ice plant. Why? Because ammonia is a refrigerant which is having very high latent heat of vaporization. The work required for, what you can say, compressing or using ammonia as a refrigerant, that is very less. So, for ammonia, the horsepower required per ton of the refrigeration is very less. And what is a good thing, guys, other than this, you know, ammonia is a toxic gas, but the gas, the smell of this ammonia is very pungent smell. Okay. It is very irritating. So if there is some kind of ammonia leakage there in some reason, surely the person will be able to, you can say, get that information. Yes, there is some kind of ammonia leakage. Okay. So that gas is not smellless. It is having some smell, and easily after inhaling that, you will get the information. Yes, there is an ammonia leakage, and you will immediately leave that space. Continuous inhaling can cause problem, but like suppose if you inhaled that gas in a very small, you can say, concentration, so that is not going to affect us. Okay. But yes, long time inhalation can cause problem. Okay. So that is the reason we use ammonia, because if there is a leakage, like we can easily detect that leakage of ammonia. Okay. And another thing, guys, you know, ammonia and water, they're having very high affinity. You know, we use ammonia and water in vapor absorption refrigeration system. Ammonia we use as a refrigerant, and water we use as an absorbent. So water and ammonia, they are having very high affinity. So if there is any kind of ammonia leakage, you can directly spray water over there. And if you will spray water, easily that ammonia will condense and it will be absorbed by the water. Are you getting this? So if there is gas leakage, there is ammonia leakage, by spraying water, you can reduce, you can say control that, what you can say, concentration, you can decrease. Okay. So let's move to the next question, guys. Brine is actually a secondary refrigerant. If any person will ask you, or you will face some question, what is brine? Brine is actually a mixture of sodium chloride, NaCl, and water. Water and NaCl, that mixture is known as brine, and it is not a primary refrigerant. We are not going to use brine as a refrigerant. It is actually a secondary refrigerant. Okay, we also use brine in you can say milk industry. Okay, chiller plants also we use this brine. It's as a secondary refrigerant. Okay, ferrone, again very important class of refrigerant. Okay, R11, R12, those are the ferrone family. You know, R12, that is a having brand name, ferrone family, ferrone series. So those refrigerants, they are also having very good properties, okay, for using as a refrigerant. Okay, but yes, they are having very high global warming potential and ozone gas depletion. So those are nowadays replaced. Nowadays we use R134a, like in our ACs. Okay, that is also going to replace in developed country already. Like that refrigerant was replaced, then they are using R408a. Okay, but yes, in India also slowly this R134a will be replaced. Okay. In air conditioner, we use R22. Most of the time, we use R22. Okay. What is a good thing with ammonia, guys? That is actually naturally occurring substance. So there is no such kind of patent required for production of ammonia. You know, but like suppose if you want to use any kind of refrigerant like R22, R134A, or any special class of refrigerant, you cannot produce, because like if some of the industry, like after carrying out research, they develop some kind of refrigerant. So they are having a patent of that refrigerant. Okay. So you need to take permission from them if you want to produce that refrigerant. But for ammonia, it is not a problem. It is a naturally occurring substance. So you can produce. Okay. So in India, like in kind of what you can say, developing country, easily you can produce ammonia, and so that the cost of the refrigerant is very less. So if the patent is required for producing some kind of refrigerant, then what easily you can understand the cost of producing that refrigerant will be high. Okay, this is open market. Like if there is some refrigerant which or what you can say, if there is some medicine which is openly available, okay, anybody can produce, so obviously the cost of that medicine will be less. Okay, but suppose if some company is having a patent of that medicine, and that only that company is going to produce, so wahan pe kya ho jayega, there will be some kind of monopoly, and the cost of that product will be high. Okay, so there are lots of factor which are in favor of ammonia, and that is the reason why we use ammonia as a refrigerant. Chaliye. So guys, next question in front of you, the condenser and evaporator tubes of a ferrone refrigerant plant. Okay, in ferrone refrigerant plant, we use tubes made up of copper. Okay, ferrone refrigerant plant, we use tubes made up of copper. Okay, with ammonia, we use tubes of steels. Okay, with ammonia, we use tubes made up of steel, and with ferrone family, we use tubes made up of copper. Okay, so very simple question, can be asked in PSUs. Chaliye. So next question, guys, in front of you. On cyclometric chart, wet bulb temperature lines. Where you will get the wet bulb temperature lines? On cyclometric chart, where you will get the wet bulb temperature line? Actually, good. If it is visible, it's fine. Good. So on cyclometric chart, guys, you know, let me draw here the cyclometric chart so that you will get the basic information. On cyclometric chart, on this line, we draw what? The humidity ratio, W. Okay, the how much water vapor is present per kg of the dry air. Is known as humidity ratio. Okay, on this line, guys, we draw DPT, dry bulb temperature, and this cyclometric chart, actually this we draw for a particular pressure. Okay, so you will have a different cyclometric chart, but generally we draw the cyclometric chart at atmospheric pressure, P atmospheric. Okay, but yes, like if you want more specific cyclometric chart, then you can refer to cyclometric chart at a pressure higher or lower than that, atmospheric pressure, depending on the condition. But yes, in general, we use a cyclometric chart which is drawn for atmospheric pressure. So this entire chart is drawn for what? Atmospheric pressure. So this is also constant. Here you will have DPT, this is W, and here you will have relative humidity lines, something like this. Relative humidity lines. Okay. Relative humidity at this particular line, here the relative humidity will be 100%. Okay, this we represent by what? Relative humidity we represent by phi. Okay, so phi is 100%. Relative humidity is 100% at this particular line, guys. Okay, and these are the lines, guys, which are going to represent WBT or constant enthalpy line, something like this. These are WBT and constant enthalpy line. Okay, although there is a very small difference between WBT and constant enthalpy line, but that difference is very small. That's why we draw them as a single line only on cyclometric chart. Okay, so WBT line are straight inclined lines, but they are sloping downward to the right, something like this. Okay, these are the lines, you can say sloping downward to the right. Okay, constant volume line will be something like this. They are having more slope, something like this. These are your constant volume lines, specific volume line. Okay, constant specific volume lines. Okay, and here you can draw these constant W line, constant humidity ratio, something like this. You can draw constant DPT lines also. Okay, so these are the line, guys, which you need to know. DPT, dry bulb temperature, humidity ratio, this relative humidity line, and these are the WBT and constant enthalpy line, and these are your specific volume line. So both specific volume and these WBT line, they are inclined line. And they are sloping downward. They are having negative slope. Okay. And the slope of specific constant specific volume line, this is more than these WBT lines. Okay. So for this question, option C is the right answer. Chaliye. So next question, guys, in front of you. Air is normally dehumidified by. How you will answer this question, guys? Air is normally dehumidified by. How we dehumidify air? Air is normally dehumidified by. Guys, yes, please try to respond. Four options: injecting water, passing steam, heating and cooling. How we dehumidify air? Very simple question. Abhi dekho ek bacche ne mistake kar diya, C kar diya. How air is dehumidified? What do you mean by dehumidify, guys? Water vapor is removed. Removal of water vapor. Removal of water vapor. Okay, and if water vapor you are removing, means W is going to decrease. W humidity ratio is going to decrease. So how we can remove water vapor? By cooling the air below DPT. Okay, by cooling the air below DPT. So if you maintain the cooling coil temperature at DPT or below DPT, the water vapor present in the air, that will be easily able to condense, and you will be able to remove the water from the air. Okay, but how we humidify air? So these are the different processes: by injecting water, by passing steam, by heating. Okay, sorry, no heating se to kya hoga aapka? It will what? Sensible heating. So humidity ratio will remain constant, W will be constant, there will be no change in the water vapor. Okay, but can you show, like, these two processes, injecting water and passing steam, what will be the difference? If you are only injecting water over the steam, so the process will be what? Cooling and humidification. Cold water or normal water, if you are injecting over the what you can say air, the process will be cooling and humidification. But if you are injecting steam or if you are passing steam into the air, the process will be heating and humidification. So it depends. Like steam pass kar rahe ho, so the process will be heating and humidification. And if you are passing injecting water, that is a cooling and dehumidification, like the evaporative cooling. And if you are cooling the air by passing over the cooling coil, which is maintained at a temperature below the DPT, okay, apparatus dew point temperature, so that process is we use for removing the water vapor present in the air. Okay, so for this present question, the right answer is what? Cooling is the right answer. Let's move to the next question, guys. Subcooling in a vapor compression refrigeration cycle. Okay, what is the use of subcooling in vapor compression refrigeration cycle? सबकूलिंग क्या होता है बच्चों? व्हाट इज द सबकूलिंग? ओके, इफ द रेफ्रिजरेंट कमिंग आउट फ्रॉम द कंडेंसर एट ए टेम्परेचर लोअर देन द टी सेचुएशन, दैट इज नोन एज सबकूलिंग. ओके, सिमिलरली व्हाट इज सुपर हीटिंग? इफ द रेफ्रिजरेंट कमिंग आउट ऑफ द इवोपरेटर एट ए टेम्परेचर मोर देन टी सेचुएशन, दैट इज नोन एज सुपर हीटिंग. आर यू गेटिंग द आइडिया? सो इन VCRS साइकिल समथिंग लाइक दिस, इफ यू विल ड्रॉ, सो दिस इज योर सिचुएशन कर्व. ओके, एंड हियर यू कैन ड्रॉ, दिस इज योर कंडेंसर पॉइंट, this is isenthalpic expansion, something like this. Let me draw it by a dotted line. So this is heat addition, this is your compression process. Okay, and then you will have what? You will have a constant pressure heat rejection, something like this. Okay, so something like this you can show. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4. 1 to 2 constant pressure, constant temperature, heat addition in the evaporator. 2 to 3 isentropic, what? Isentropic compression process in the compressor. 3 to 4 constant pressure heat rejection in the condenser. This is the heat rejection. Okay, and 4 to 1 is the isenthalpic expansion process. Okay, so if the refrigerant is coming out from the condenser at a temperature lower than this T saturation, okay, so agar main yahan pe suppose if I'm taking the temperature here and here the entropy TS diagram, so this will be the refrigerant. Okay, this will be the refrigerant. So refrigerant is coming out at a temperature T4 dash is less than T4. Okay, this is known as what? Subcooling. Okay, this process is known as subcooling. So then the refrigerant expansion will be something like this. Okay, so this is 1 dash. So refrigeration effect is going to increase. W compressor will remain same. This is going to remain same or unaffected. So by carrying out, you can say this subcooling, the refrigeration effect will increase. W compressor is going to remain same. And what you can conclude, sir, COP is going to increase. Why? Because COP is the refrigeration effect produced divided by compressor work. As compressor work is same, refrigeration effect is increasing. So COP by carrying out subcooling is going to increase. Okay. What is superheating, guys? Superheating, if the refrigerant coming out of the evaporator at a temperature more than the T saturation, because here what is T saturation, guys? This temperature is T saturation in the evaporator. This is the T saturation in the condenser. So refrigerant coming out of the condenser at a temperature lower than T saturation, and guys, this difference T4 minus T4 dash, this is known as a degree of subcooling. Degree of subcooling. Are you getting the idea? Degree of subcooling. Similarly, if the refrigerant is coming out at a temperature more than this, means 2 dash, so this is the again new process. So this is what? This is the compression, and this is the point where the refrigerant is leaving from the evaporator at a temperature more than T saturation. So T2 dash is more than T2, and this difference, guys, this difference T2 dash minus T2, this is known as degree of superheating. Degree of superheating. Okay, so very, very important question for CSL. What you need to know, when you are carrying out subcooling, the refrigeration effect is going to increase, COP is going to increase, WC will remain constant. When you are carrying out superheating, if you are carrying out inside the evaporator, the refrigeration effect is going to increase always. But what is the condition? If you are carrying out superheating in the evaporator, but suppose if you are carrying out superheating in the liquid suction heat exchanger, like liquid suction heat exchanger is not a part of evaporator. So if you are carrying out superheating in the you can say liquid suction heat exchanger, that is not going to increase the refrigeration effect. So refrigeration effect will remain same. Okay, and always with the superheating, W compressor increases. With the superheating, W compressor always increases. Why? Due to T2 dash, entry temperature into the compressor. As the entry temperature to the compressor increases, compressor work increases. Are you getting the idea, guys? So superheating, W compressor always increases. Refrigeration effect can also increase if we are carrying out superheating in the evaporator. Okay, so in general, with superheating, COP can increase or decrease. COP aapka bad bhi sakta hai. COP can increase or decrease. It depends on the refrigerant. So for R11, R12, COP increases. For ammonia, COP decreases. So it depends on the refrigerant. With superheating, the COP can increase, COP can decrease also. It depends on the type of refrigerant. Are you getting the idea, guys? So see, what are the important points? Let me tell you. You can say superheating, WC will always increase. Compressor work will always increase. Second, the refrigeration effect can also increase if you are carrying out superheating inside the evaporator. And the net effect, COP can increase or decrease. It depends on the type of refrigerant. For ammonia, it is going to decrease. For R11, R12, the COP is going to increase. What is the effect of subcooling in this question? Subcooling, the refrigeration effect always going to increase. WC is going to remain same. And COP is going to increase by carrying out what? Subcooling. Okay. So in this question, if you will answer, subcooling in the vapor compression refrigeration system decreases the work. No, this is not right. Increases the required work. This is also not right. Does not affect the required work and increases the refrigeration effect. So option D is the right answer, guys. Option D is the right answer for this question. Very good. Chaliye. Next question in front of you. If a reheater is added to a Rankine cycle, then usually, if a reheater is added to a Rankine cycle, reheater kya hota hai bachcho? Reheater. You know, in multi-stage expansion, in turbine, we expand generally, like in a Rankine cycle, thermal power plant, we expand the steam in multiple stages. Okay, so that work output will increase. And before going to expand the steam in multiple turbines, we reheat the steam. Okay, so reheating. What is the effect of reheating, guys? Network and efficiency increases. Network and efficiency decreases. Network remains same, efficiency increases. Network increases and efficiency remains same. So what is the answer you will go with? GH is saying D. Vinod is saying A. Raj Mohan is also saying A. So guys, with reheating, note down important points. Dryness fraction increases. First thing. The dryness fraction of the steam increases. The quality of steam increases at the exit of the turbine. That is the first point. Work, W turbine increases. Network also. Okay, W turbine, W net increases. Okay. With the reheating, dryness fraction, the quality of steam at the turbine exit increases. W turbine, W net increases. Okay. Efficiency can increase or decrease. Efficiency can increase or decrease. Can increase or decrease. It depends on the reheat pressure. Okay. It depends on the reheat pressure. So if the ratio of the reheat pressure divided by the boiler pressure is equal to what? 0.2 to 0.25. Okay. If the reheat pressure and the boiler pressure, the ratio of the reheat pressure to the boiler pressure, it is in this range, 0.2 to 0.25, the efficiency is going to increase. तब तो एफिशिएंसी क्या करेगा बच्चों? एफिशिएंसी विल इंक्रीज. ओके, एफिशिएंसी बढ़ेगा. अदरवाइज इफ दिस रेशियो इज व्हाट लोअर देन दैट, देन एफिशिएंसी इज गोइंग टू व्हाट? डिक्रीज. ओके, इवन इफ इट इज मोर देन दैट, देन एफिशिएंसी इज गोइंग टू डिक्रीज. ओके, सो एट दिस रेशियो, रीहीट प्रेशर बाय बॉयलर प्रेशर, इफ इट इज इन दिस रेंज, द एफिशिएंसी विल बी मैक्सिमम. ओके, एंड एफिशिएंसी इज गोइंग टू इंक्रीज. सो इट डिपेंड्स ऑन द रीहीट प्रेशर. ऑलवेज यू कैन नॉट से कि एफिशिएंसी इज गोइंग टू डिक्रीज. व्हाट इज द रीजन, गाइस? You know, like when you are carrying out reheating, let me draw here the Rankine cycle so that you will get the information. So this is temperature, this is entropy line, and let me draw here the phase change curve. So for reheating, you will have a diagram something like this. This is condenser exit. Okay, so this is isentropic compression and this is constant pressure heat addition. Okay, and then you will have here, let me first draw the cycle only. So that because we are going to show the reheating process. So this is condenser exit, something like this, and this is constant pressure. Okay, so let me take here this curve, something like this. Okay, and here you can show the reheating process. Something like this. Okay, so this is the curve. I'm showing something like this. Yes. Okay. So this is your critical point and you will have a cycle something like this. Okay. So this is, guys, this is point, you can say this is the pump inlet, pump work, WP. Okay. This is your turbine exit. Okay. And this is your condenser exit. Okay. So this process, like suppose 1 to 2 is isentropic expansion in the turbine, lower pressure turbine. Okay. This 2 to 3 is the heat rejection in the condenser. 3 to 4 is the isentropic compression in the pump, and 3 to 5 is the heat addition in the economizer section. 5 to 6 is the heat addition in the you can say evaporator section. 6 to 7 is the heat addition in the superheater. Okay, so this 6 to 7 is the superheating process. Let me zoom it for you so that you will get the idea. So 2 to 3 heat rejection in the condenser, 3 to 4 pumping process, 4 to 5 heat addition in the economizer, 5 to 6 heat addition in the evaporator section, 6 to 7 heat addition in the superheater. So this, guys, this 7 to 8 is the heat expansion in the turbine, high pressure turbine. So this is expansion in turbine 1. Okay, this 8 to 1 is known as the reheating process. Isse hum kya bolte hain? Reheating. Okay, this is known as reheating. 8 to 1, this is known as reheating. And again, what is 1 to 2? It is an expansion in the second turbine, T2. Okay, so 7 to 8 expansion in turbine T1, 1 to 2 is the expansion in turbine T2, and this 8 to 1 is known as reheating. So guys, this is your reheating pressure. Ye jo pressure hai, this is the reheating pressure. Okay, this pressure is the reheating pressure. Okay, so this P1 equal to P8, this is equal to reheat pressure. Okay, reheat pressure. And what is boiler pressure, guys? The boiler pressure is nothing but P6 equal to P7. Okay, because this is actually a constant pressure line. We are assuming heat addition at a constant pressure. So if the ratio of this reheat pressure divided by boiler pressure, if it is equal to 0.2 or 0.25, then only you can say the efficiency is going to increase. Why? Because if this ratio is less, like here, if this reheat pressure is very low, okay, reheat pressure is very low. Suppose you are reheating at a very low pressure. Okay, so what will happen? If reheat pressure is very low, then that ratio will be very less. Okay, what will happen, guys? If you are reheating the steam with the flue gases, so their temperature difference will be very high. Okay, and due to the finite temperature difference between the flue gases and the steam which is expanding into the turbine, the irreversibilities will be more and efficiency will be less. So efficiency is going to increase if the finite temperature difference between the flue gases and the steam will be less, and that is going to happen if the reheat pressure in this ratio. Okay, so some important information, guys, I discussed with you. So for this question, there is no such option with the efficiency can increase or decrease. There is no such option. So what you can go with? You can go with the network and efficiency increases. You can go with option A. Okay, so it is better to go with option A. Why? Because there is no option with efficiency increases or decreases. Okay, guys, but if you will find some option with efficiency can increase or decrease, work output is always going to increase. Efficiency can increase or decrease. So then you need to go with that option. Chaliye. So guys, let's move to the next question. Next question pe move karte hain. Just a second. Chaliye. So next question, guys, in front of you, the Babcock and Wilcox boiler is considered as. The Babcock and Wilcox boiler is considered as. Babcock and Wilcox boiler is considered as natural convection fire tube, forced convection fire tube, natural convection water tube, forced convection water tube. I know, guys, you are facing some problem. Okay, why? Because there is a clarity issue. And so shortly we are going to fix this. Okay, but this time I cannot do anything in that. Okay, I can only say sorry to you. Okay, yes, I know, like, you are facing some clarity issue. Okay, I'm changing each and every time. I'm changing the back black color, the background. So okay, so Babcock and Wilcox boiler, guys, it is a natural convection water tube boiler. Natural convection water tube boiler. Okay, and other than this, what you need to know, this is actually a medium pressure boiler. Medium pressure boiler. Medium pressure boiler. Okay, I told you yesterday also, that point is very, very important for you. Okay. okay, good. So guys, I told you, like, if the pressure, boiler pressure, if it is less than or equal to 20 bar, okay, if the boiler pressure is less than equal to 20 bar, that boiler is known as what? Usse hum kya bolte hain? Let me write it here. If the boiler pressure PB, if it is less than equal to 20, this is known as low pressure boiler. Okay, this is known as low pressure boiler, and all fire tube boiler, guys, are low pressure. Like, if I will say to you, like, locomotive boiler, Cochrane boiler, okay, all fire tube boilers are what? They are low pressure boiler. Okay, and if the boiler pressure is in the range of 20 to 80, this is known as medium pressure. Okay, in medium pressure, most of the boiler you are going to find out what? Water tube boiler, but natural circulation. Water tube, natural circulation. High pressure boiler in the range of 80 to 180, these are high pressure boiler. And in high pressure, guys, what you will find? You will find forced circulation, water tube. Okay, low pressure, fire tube boiler. Medium pressure, water tube, natural circulation. High pressure boiler, water tube, forced circulation. When you are forcing the water at a high, you can say, pressure, then also the steam generation will be at a high pressure. So high pressure boiler, these are generally water tube with forced circulation. Okay, and last one is what? Supercritical. Okay, if the pressure is what? The PB is more than 220 bar. Close to 220 bar. Okay, you can say. Then that boiler is known as a supercritical boiler. Okay, supercritical boiler. Are you getting the idea, guys? Theek hai, chaliye. So, Babcock's Wilcox, natural circulation, fire tube boilers. Next question, guys, in front of you. In case of SI engine to have high thermal efficiency, the fuel air mixture ratio should be maximum thermal efficiency, guys. High thermal efficiency, you know, stoichiometric or chemically correct. Chemically correct. What do you mean by stoichiometric or chemically correct? The air required for the complete combustion of a fuel, that is known as stoichiometric or chemically correct air fuel ratio. For petrol or gasoline or for petrol, the stoichiometric air fuel ratio is 14.7:1. Okay, for diesel, it is 14.5:1. Okay, so this much is the amount of air required for the gasoline. This much is the amount of air required for the diesel. 14.5 times of the fuel. So 14.5:1, this is the air fuel ratio for the diesel. 14.7 is the air fuel ratio for the petrol. This is not the air fuel ratio for the maximum efficiency. This is the air fuel ratio which is required for the complete combustion of the charge of the fuel. So that is known as stoichiometric or chemically correct. Okay, for getting the maximum thermal efficiency, guys, we need to supply slightly lean. Slightly lean means in the range of 16:1. Okay, so close to 16:1, you will get maximum thermal efficiency. So maximum thermal efficiency will be with slightly lean mixture. Maximum higher power. Okay, high power. For high power, or what you can say, high acceleration, we require slightly rich. Slightly rich means in the range of 13.5:1. Okay, so you need to have some basic idea. This is the what? This is known as the stoichiometric air fuel ratio. Stoichiometric air fuel ratio for petrol and diesel. This is the stoichiometric air fuel ratio required for the high thermal efficiency. This is the answer is this. For this question, the right answer is option A. But this is the air fuel ratio which is required for maximum power. सर कल ना एक बच्चे के मैसेजेस आ रहे थे यूट्यूब पे, तो वो कल भी हमने मैंने कहा था कि उसको ब्लॉक कर दें, ब्लॉक नहीं हुआ वो. गुरविंदर सर आज भी सेम इशू है, वो बड़ा आधे घंटे से मेरे वो क्लियरिटी इशू है भाई, आ नहीं रही क्लियर। मैं स्क्रीन चेंज कर करके पढ़ा रहा हूँ। नहीं इसमें है सर, यूट्यूब पे नहीं आते। कुछ ना कुछ है, तो लाइटिंग का है, मैंने लाइट भी बंद की है कुछ, उसके बाद कुछ बात बनी है, बैकग्राउंड ब्लैक किया है, फिर शायद कुछ बात।
चलो आप देख
लेते हैं। ये है सर जी, सो इन केस ऑफ एसआई इंजन यू विल गेट मैक्सिमम एफिशिएंसी विद स्लाइटली लीन मिक्सचर। गाइस दिस रेशियो यू कैन रिप्रेजेंट इन टर्म्स ऑफ इक्विवेलेंट, यू कैन से यू नो इक्विवेलेंस रेशियो, देयर इज अ टर्म व्हिच इज नोन एज इक्विवेलेंस रेशियो। This is actual fuel air ratio. Fuel air ratio actual divided by fuel air ratio stoichiometric. Okay. Equivalence ratio is known as fuel air ratio, actual fuel air ratio divided by stoichiometric fuel air ratio. Okay. And what you need to understand, guys, phi will be what? It will be 0.85. Close to 0.85 for what? Maximum efficiency. Okay, so phi will be 0.85 for maximum efficiency, and phi will be close to 1.1 to 1.15 for maximum power. Okay, so some basic stuff, basic information you need to know. If phi equivalence ratio is equal to 1, the actual fuel air ratio, stoichiometric air fuel ratio, both are same. So means the what you can say, you will get the stoichiometric fuel. Okay, so phi equal to 1 means you will have stoichiometric air fuel ratio. Phi less than 1 means you are having lean mixture. Phi greater than 1, you are having rich mixture. Are you getting? So you need to have clarity about this air fuel ratio also. This is actually air fuel ratio, guys. When we are writing something like this, this is air fuel ratio. Okay. 14.7 ratio 1, 13.5 ratio 1, 16 ratio 1, these are the air fuel ratio. But what is fuel air ratio, guys? Fuel air ratio will be reverse of this. Okay. So, agar aap yahan se agar aap ye karte ho, then generally student did this particular mistake. They write phi as this is the air fuel ratio, what? 16 ratio 1, this is the actual fuel ratio. What is stoichiometric air fuel ratio? That is 14.7. Means this number will become greater than 1. But in actual case, the fuel is lean mixture. You are using higher air, much air. Okay, so this mixture is lean. Why you are getting phi more than 1? Because you are using the wrong concept. Why? Because this phi is the fuel air ratio, actual fuel air ratio divided by stoichiometric fuel air ratio. So you cannot write it something like this. You need to write it as 1/16, okay, into 1/47, means 47 will go into the numerator and 16 will go into the denominator. Why? Because this is air fuel ratio and phi is fuel air ratio, guys. Okay, so you go to the point. Let me tell you again, phi 0.85 maximum efficiency, phi 1.1, 1.5 maximum power, phi equal to 1 stoichiometric air fuel ratio, and air fuel ratio, if it is close to 16 ratio 1, you will get maximum efficiency. If phi is equal to 13.5 ratio 1, you will get maximum power, and if it is 14.5 to 14.7, that you will get stoichiometric air fuel ratio. Okay, for idling also we required a very rich mixture, because in idling, no load condition, the exhaust gas dilution takes place, and due to exhaust gas dilution, we require rich mixture in case of idling also. In cold starting, idling, in all these cases, we required very rich mixture. Chaliye, let's move to the next question, guys. For the same output, same power, same compression ratio, the thermal efficiency of a two-stroke petrol engine as compared to four-stroke petrol engine. Okay. For the same output, same speed, same compression ratio, the thermal efficiency of a two-stroke petrol engine as compared to four-stroke petrol engine. Yes, guys, please try to answer. Obviously, the efficiency of two-stroke is less than efficiency of four-stroke. Okay, let me tell you some more points. You know, the volumetric efficiency of two-stroke, that is also less as compared to the volumetric efficiency of four-stroke. Work output of two-stroke, work, W net. Okay, that for two-stroke, it will be more. W will be more for what? For two-stroke in comparison to four-stroke. Okay, but efficiency, both thermal efficiency, volumetric efficiency, and fuel consumption. Okay, fuel consumption will also be more in case of two stroke as compared to four stroke. Are you getting the idea, guys? Okay, why? because in two stroke engine there is like we are not having any dedicated single stroke. There is no such exhaust stroke. Okay, the strokes they are taking in combination, so that's why we will not get a single suction stroke. That's why the volumetric efficiency will be less. The thermal efficiency will be less. Why? Because there are so many losses. Due to sequencing of the charge, some kind of unburned charge will go with exhaust gases. So we will have that loss of charge. So that is also going to cause decrease in thermal efficiency. And one more important point is when we are expanding the gas, okay, because there is no such a single expansion or power stroke, so you will not get sufficient time to completely burn the charge. Okay, so due to that, the exhaust gases we will have unburnt charge, and if there is unburnt charge, the fuel consumption will be more and thermal efficiency will be less. The thermal efficiency of two stroke engine is less, guys. There are two factors: due to the incomplete combustion of the charge. Second, due to the sequencing, some charge will go outside without combusting. Okay, so due to that loss of the charge also, the thermal efficiency is less, but that loss of charge will be there in case of two stroke petrol engine only. In case of two stroke diesel engine, only the air is entering. Okay, but for two stroke diesel engine also, the efficiency is lower than four stroke diesel. Why? In two stroke diesel engine, the fuel is not going to go out. Why? Because there is no such air fuel mixture we are supplying. We are only supplying air, but then also the efficiency is less because the incomplete combustion will be there in case of two stroke engine. In case of four stroke engine, we are having single suction stroke, single compression stroke, single expansion or power stroke, and single exhaust stroke. So we are having for each and every process, we are having a dedicated stroke. But in case of two stroke engine, there is no such dedicated stroke for exhaust or power, what you can say. So incomplete combustion will be there, and due to that, the thermal efficiency of two stroke will be always less than four stroke. Volumetric efficiency will also be low, fuel consumption will be high, but W net will be more. Okay, so that's why two stroke engine we will use if what we want lighter size engine, if you want light engine. Okay, because the work output is more, the economy will be high, not good. Economy of two stroke engine is not good, but the weight will be very less as compared to four stroke engine. That's why we use this engine in marine application. Like initially we use, but nowadays those old engines were replaced by four stroke diesel engine. This time you're not going to find out a two stroke. Some old ships you will find, but most of the engines you will find of two four stroke diesel engine only. Okay, chaliye. So I hope you got the point, guys. For this question, the right answer is option B. Option B is the right answer. As the pressure increases, the saturation temperature of vapor. Pressure badhega to saturation temperature pe kya farak padega? What will be the effect on saturation temperature, guys? Please try to respond. As the pressure increases, to T saturation pe kya farak padta hai? Very simple question. What is this? This is a constant pressure line. P1, P2, P3. So what is the saturation temperature here? This is T1, saturation temperature. Okay, suppose this is temperature versus entropy line. So this is T1. Okay, this is T2. Okay, this is T3. And as you can easily observe, as the pressure increases, the T saturation is also increases. So this T saturation is nothing but the boiling point. Okay, this is nothing but the boiling point. So for water, what is the boiling point at 1 atmospheric? So at 1 atmospheric, the boiling point of water is 100 degrees Celsius. So if you'll increase the pressure, what will happen? Its boiling point is going to increase. So in pressure cooker, what we are doing? We are increasing the pressure. Okay. And in pressure cooker, when we increase the pressure, the water boiling point increases. And due to increase in boiling point, it is going to take more heat. It is going to absorb more heat. Okay. Why? Because its boiling point is now very high. Okay. And when it will absorb more heat, so it will be easily able to transmit that heat to the foodstuff, and we will be able to cook the food faster. But if the boiling point is less, what will happen? The water will easily evaporate. It will convert into vapor, and it will go in the top of the chamber, in the top of the pressure cooker, or simply it will go out. Okay. So if the boiling point is low, the water will not be able to transmit its heat to the food stove. Simply it will boil, it will convert into vapor, and it will go out. But if the boiling point of water is high, then the heat absorbed by the water will be very high before going to convert into steam. Okay. And if it is absorbing much and much heat, it will be able to transmit that heat to the food stuff. So what idea you need to have? As the pressure increases, boiling point, T saturation increases. As the pressure decreases, boiling point or T saturation decreases. So if you want to boil water at say 30 degrees Celsius, you can boil, but you need to decrease the pressure. At 1 atmospheric, the boiling point is 100, and if you will decrease the pressure, the boiling point will also what? Decreases. Okay, so you can boil water at 30 degrees Celsius also, 20 degree also, 10 degree also, it depends on the pressure. Are you getting? Chaliye. So for this question, the right answer is increases. Option A is the right answer. Chaliye, let's move to the next question, guys. Boiling point and freezing point for water are marked on a temperature scale P, degree P. There is a scale degree P. Okay, good guys. Thank you. There is a scale degree P. What will be the reading on the scale corresponding to 60 degrees Celsius? Very simple question, guys. These type of question easily you can solve. If you will draw here two lines, here you can draw the degree Celsius scale. So on degree Celsius scale, what is a freezing point? This is freezing point. This is boiling point. On degree Celsius scale, freezing point is 0 degree Celsius. Boiling point is 100 degree Celsius. On degree P scale, boiling point is what, guys? The boiling point is 130 P. Okay. So this is 130 P. This is boiling point. What is the freezing point? The freezing point is minus 20 P. Okay. So this is degree Celsius scale. This is degree P scale. Okay. Something like this. You can solve this problem. Then what is given to us? Here the temperature is 60 degrees Celsius. We want this corresponding temperature on degree P. Okay. We want corresponding temperature in degree P. So what you can say, write it here. You can consider this as X. Okay. You can consider this as X. Okay. Next, what you need to write it here? 60 minus 0. This 60 minus 0 divided by scale length 100 minus 0. Similarly, here also you can write X minus 20 means X plus 20. X minus 20. So it will become X plus 20 divided by 130 minus 20. It will become 150. 60 minus 0, 100 minus 0. X minus 20, 130 minus 20. You will get this. Okay. So you can write this as 60 by 100 equal to X plus 20 divided by 150. So this will cancel out. This will cancel out. You will get X plus 20 equal to 90. Okay. And you will get X equal to 70 degree P. So the temperature corresponding to 60 degree Celsius is 70 degree P. Okay. Temperature corresponding to 60 degree Celsius is 70 degree P, guys. Okay. So for this question, the right answer is 70 degree P, means option B is the right answer. Okay. Option B is the right answer. Okay. Is that clear, guys? Please confirm. Yes, very good. Very good, guys. Chali, let's move to the next question. There is a closed balloon containing 10 kg of helium. Mass of helium is what? 10 kg. It receives 5 kilojoule of heat. There is a balloon, something like this. Okay, there is a balloon. Okay, there is a balloon. It is containing mass helium, 10 kg. Okay, it is receiving heat. It is receiving heat, how much? 5 kilojoule per kg. 5 kilojoule per kg is the heat received by this balloon. During this process, the volume of this balloon changes. Iska volume kya ho raha hai bachcho? Change kar raha hai. Okay. The volume of this balloon changes. So dV is given to us 0.2 meter cube. The volume of this balloon changes with 0.2 meter cube at constant pressure. Okay. So the pressure is what? Constant 100 kilopascal. Pressure constant is 100 kilopascal. What is the change in internal energy? What is the change in internal energy for the helium gas present inside this balloon? This is a very simple question, guys. And easily you can answer this question. You know, guys, for first law of thermodynamics, we know dQ equal to dU plus dW. This is first law of thermodynamics for a process, any process in a closed system, reversible or irreversible. So what is dQ? dQ is the heat added. How much heat you are adding? 5 kilojoule per kg. But how much is the mass? That is 10 kg. So how much heat you are adding? You are adding 50 kilojoule of heat. you are adding 50 kilojoule of heat, guys. How you can say? The heat added is 5 kilojoule per kg. So mass inside this balloon is 10 kg. So 10 multiplied by 5 means 50 kilojoule heat we are adding. DU, we want to find out what is DW. At constant pressure, we can write this as a PdV. Constant pressure work, we can write it as a PdV. So if you write it here, DU equal to 50 minus PdV. What is pressure? Pressure is 100 kilopascal. What is dV? It is 0.2. So simply if you will solve, you will get the answer 50 minus 20. So it is 30 kilojoule. Change in internal energy is 30 kilojoule means option C is the right answer for this question. Okay. Option C is the right answer, guys, for this question. Very good, Vinod. Keep it up. Good. Others also, guys, please try to respond, try to answer. Very simple question. Okay. I hope it is clear to you now, all of you. Please confirm. Next question, guys, in front of you. A four-stroke engine, the compression ratio is this. The compression ratio is given to you, four-stroke diesel engine. The compression ratio is 21:1. Okay. The cutoff ratio is 2:1. He is asking you the expansion ratio. What is the expansion ratio? What is the expansion ratio? Compression ratio 20:1. Cutoff ratio 2:1. What is the expansion ratio? You know, guys, in diesel cycle, if you draw here the pressure versus volume diagram, you will have a plot something like this. Okay, so this is 1, this is 2, 3, 4. Okay, something like this. So this V2 is nothing but clearance volume. V2 ko hum kya bolte hain? Clearance volume. This V1 is nothing but total volume. This V1 minus V2 is nothing but swept volume. V1 minus V2 is known as swept volume. Okay, V2 is clearance, V1 is total, V1 minus V2 is swept volume. Okay, and this ratio, guys, in this here, you can write, let me write it here. In this diagram, you know, this ratio of V1 by V2, this is nothing but this is known as a compression ratio. The total volume by clearance volume, this is known as a compression ratio. Okay. But the ratio of V4 by V3, guys, this is known as expansion ratio. V4 by V3, this is known as expansion ratio. Okay. So if you multiply and divide it by V2, so you can write it as V2 into V2. Yes or no? So you can write it something like this. I'm multiplying it by V2, dividing by V2. So you can write it as, what is V4, guys? V4, V1, both are same. V4 and V1, both are same. So can I replace this V1 by V2 with R? So yes, this is R. And what is V3 by V2? This is rho. So simply, you can write expansion ratio in a diesel engine is nothing but compression ratio divided by cutoff ratio. What is compression ratio, sir? It is 20. What is cutoff ratio, sir? It is 2. So you will get 10.5:1. Okay. So it will be 10.5:1. Okay. So means option B is the right answer for this question. So directly also you can remember. Directly you can remember what is expansion ratio. Okay. So expansion ratio is the compression ratio divided by cutoff ratio. Okay. Theek hai bachon? Is that clear? Please confirm. So very simple question. I hope you got the point. Let's move to next question. A gas in a container A is in thermal equilibrium with another gas B. Okay. A gas in container A is in thermal equilibrium with another gas of the same mass in container B. Okay. The corresponding pressure and volumes are denoted by PA, VB. PA is the pressure in the A, PB is the pressure in the B, VA is the volume of A, VB is the volume of B. So what will be the relationship between pressure and volume? Try to answer this question, guys. Very simple question. Please apply your mind. A gas in a container A is in thermal equilibrium with another gas B. A gas in container A is in thermal equilibrium with another gas of the same mass in the container. If the corresponding pressure and volume are denoted by suffixes A and B, then which of the following statement is true? Please try to answer. Okay, Vinod is saying C. Only one response I got this time. Yes, Abdullah, hello. Very good. Yes, Vinod, now your answer is right. Very good. So this is not C, this is D actually. This is the right answer, right? So A, B, C, D. D is the right answer because for a temperature constant process, if the temperature is constant, we can say PV equal to constant. Okay. For an ideal gas, temperature constant, PV equal to constant, or what you can say, you can write it here, P1V1 equal to P2V2, or what you can say, if these are in thermal equilibrium, they are at constant temperature. So we can say PA, VA equal to PB, VB. Okay. At constant temperature, you can use this relationship between pressure and volume. So this is the right option for this question. Okay, guys. Is that clear? Chaliye, let's move to next question. In spark ignition engine, the possibility of knocking can be reduced by. In spark ignition engine, the possibility of knocking can be reduced by. In spark ignition engine, the possibility of knocking can be reduced by. How we can reduce the knocking in petrol engine? You know, guys, in petrol engine, knocking takes place due to the auto ignition or the pre-ignition of the charge. Okay. And knocking takes place due to high compression ratio. If the engine temperature is high, or you are supplying the air at very high temperature, or the compression ratio is high, turbulence is less. Okay, these are the reason due to which the auto ignition, or what you can say, pre-ignition of the charge takes place. So that is pre-ignition or auto ignition of the charge in petrol engine, that is known as knocking in petrol engine. Okay, or like suppose if you advanced the spark, aapne spark ko bahut jyada advance kar diya hai. Advancing means, like generally, throatically we say we start the spark at TDC. Okay, throatically we say ki spark we initiate at TDC. But in actual case, we advance the spark. Why? Because advancing the spark results in more power. Guys, if you will retard the spark, like suppose if you will start the sparking after TDC, what will happen? If you will start the sparking after TDC, what will happen? The peak pressure will be very low. Why? Because you are starting the spark after reaching the piston to the TDC, means in expansion stroke, you are starting the spark. What will happen? The power required will be very less, very less. Okay. Why? Because in expansion stroke, when you are, you can say starting the spark, the pressure obtained will be very less because gas is expanding and you are initiating the spark. Are you getting? So power output will be very less. So to increase the power output of engine, we generally advance the spark. Okay. We advance the spark by 10 to 15 degrees. Why? Because advancing the spark results in the peak pressure close to the TDC. What we want, guys? We want peak pressure close to the TDC so that power output will be more. So during compression only we initiate the spark. During compression only we initiate the spark. That is known as spark advance. But if you will go with very high spark advance, that can cause knocking. Are you getting? Why? Because advancing the spark means you are initiating the spark in compression stroke only. So while you are compressing the gas, its temperature is very high, and during that process only you initiated the spark. So that can cause pre-ignition of the charge. So that's why we need to optimize. We need to go with some kind of, you can say, balance. Very high spark advance we cannot go with. And why spark advance is required? To get the high power. So that's why we make a compromise and we generally go with the 10 to 15 degrees spark advance. Okay, Sunil, not a problem. Good. Okay. So spark increasing, if you decrease the knocking, knocking ko agar aapko decrease karna hai, increasing compression ratio is going to increase knocking. So this is not right. Decreasing compression ratio, this is right. Increasing the coolant, that is also wrong. Advancing the spark, this is also wrong. Okay. So knocking ko hum kaise reduce kar sakte hai? Retard karke, retarding the spark. Retarding the spark. इसको रिटार्ड करके कंप्रेशन रेशियो को डिक्रीज करके इंजन टेम्परेचर को डिक्रीज करके ओके एयर टेम्परेचर को डिक्रीज करके टर्बुलेंस को इंक्रीज करके बाय इंक्रीजिंग द टर्बुलेंस ओके सो जस्ट नोट डाउन हाउ वी कैन रिटार्ड द हाउ वी कैन डिक्रीज द नोकिंग नोकिंग वी कैन डिक्रीज बाय रिटार्डिंग द स्पार्क by decreasing the compression ratio, by decreasing the engine temperature, by decreasing the air inlet temperature. That air, you know, it is entering at some temperature. Okay. So if that temperature is very high, okay, sometime it is required. You know, like suppose that is a major problem. Like suppose if you want to use methanol or ethanol, they are having very high octane number. The octane number for alcohols is more than 100, you know, methanol, ethanol, alcohol, octane number is more than 100. But what is the problem? They are not having that much volatility. Okay, so it is very difficult to form their air fuel ratio. Okay, so that's why sometime we need to preheat the mixture to get the good air fuel ratio. So if air is entering at high temperature, the mixing will be very high, very good, but that can increase the auto ignition tendency. Okay, so air temperature will be lower, turbulence will be required to be higher, but to decrease the knock, knocking ko decrease karne ke liye. Okay, knocking ko decrease karne ke liye. But if turbulence is less, advancing is spark, compression ratio is high, engine temperature is high, air temperature is high, that is going to increase the knocking tendency. I hope it is now clear to you. So for this question, B is the right answer. Okay, chaliye, let's move to next question, guys. Next question in front of you. Octane number of isooctane. Octane number of isooctane. Okay, guys, let me write it here. Reference fuels. Reference fuels. For octane number. Octane number ke liye reference fuels are what? One is isooctane. And second one is n-heptane. N-heptane is having octane number 0. Isooctane is having octane number 100. These are the reference fuels for octane number, measuring the octane number. These are the reference fuels for measuring the octane number. Isooctane and n-heptane. What are the reference fuels for cetane number, guys? Cetane number ke liye. Reference fuels are cetane, which is having cetane number 100. And another one is alpha methyl naphthalene. Which is having cetane number 0. Okay. Nowadays we use alpha methyl nonane also, which is having a cetane number close to 15. But you can remember this cetane, which is having cetane number 100, alpha methyl naphthalene, which is having cetane number 0. Okay. So these are the reference fuel. These are the reference fuel to measure the cetane number. These are the reference fuel to measure the octane number. Octane number gives us the anti-knocking tendency. Anti-knocking tendency. Okay. So if octane number is high, the anti-knocking tendency will be very high. It means you can use the engine with a high compression ratio. Are you getting the idea, guys? So where we require high octane fuel? High octane fuel, where we require? Where we want to use the high compression ratio. Like in high-speed cars, high-speed bikes, you know, racer bikes, jo hoti hai hamari. High-speed cars, high-speed bikes, we use very high compression ratio because we want very fast acceleration, we want very high power. Okay. So in those vehicles, we require fuel with very high octane number. In India, you know, we are having octane number close to 100 also. You know, IOCL, recently they launched petrol fuel with octane number 100. And the brand name of that fuel is XP100. Okay. XP100 is a brand name of the fuel launched by IOCL recently, which is having octane number 100. Okay. So, octane number is a measure of anti-knocking tendency. Cetane number is a measure of the combustion characteristic. Good is the cetane number. Good is the combustion characteristic. In India, octane number is available in the range of what? 92 to 100. These are the octane number available. For normal fuel, you will get octane number close to 92, and for the premium fuel, you will get octane number more than 95. For premium fuel, extra premium fuel, octane number is more than 95. But for high speed cars, super bikes, you can now purchase octane number 100 also. Okay, but for cetane number in Indian market, the fuel is available with cetane number 50 to 60. And it is considered as a good fuel, guys. So if you are having cetane number in the range of 50 to 60, that is considered as a good diesel fuel. So diesel cetane number is not in the range of what you can say 90 or 100 is required. Are you getting? So if cetane number is in the range of 50 to 60, that is considered as a good diesel fuel. If octane number is in this range, that is considered as a good petrol fuel, good gasoline fuel. Chaliye. So for isooctane, for octane number, isooctane is having octane number 100. So D is the right answer. Okay, let me tell you one more important thing, guys. Generally, students are having some confusion. They say, okay, sir, octane 90 means the petrol which we are having, that petrol is having 90% isooctane and what, 10% n-heptane. It doesn't mean like this, guys. 90 octane means the petrol which you are having, that is having similar anti-knocking tendency like the mixture of 90% isooctane and 10% n-heptane. Are you getting the idea, guys? So 90 octane doesn't mean like 60, 70, any number. Like suppose 95 octane. So 95 octane doesn't mean the petrol which you are having, that is having 90%, 95% isooctane, 5% n-heptane. It is not like that. What it means, how you can define 95% octane? So 95% octane means the petrol fuel which you are having, that is having similar kind of anti-knocking tendency, similar kind of anti-knocking resistance, like the mixture of 95% isooctane and 5% what? N-heptane. How we check? First, we check the our petrol fuel on our some kind of, you can say, cooperative fuel research engine. We check petrol fuel. We fix the compression ratio. At what compression ratio the knocking is taking place in the petrol engine or with the given mixture of the petrol fuel. Then what we'll do? We will remove that petrol and now we load the mixture of this combination. Okay. So at what combination we are getting the similar kind of knocking tendency? This is how we define the octane number and cetane number. I hope you got the point. What are the reference fuel for octane number and cetane number? Guys, it is not like that I'm discussing this question and the same is going to come. Why actually I am focusing on this additional data? So there will be high probability you will find same question or some kind of linked question. Okay, that's why the important stuff which is related to that particular question I am discussing with you. I hope you can understand this. Okay, so my purpose is not just that I need to cover those 40 questions. My purpose is like through those 40 questions we will be able to, you can say, cover 100 questions. Okay, so that there will be high probability to face those kind of questions in the final examination. Chaliye, let's move to the next question, guys. The equivalent evaporation of a boiler producing 2000 kg per hour of steam with enthalpy content of 2426 kilojoule per kg from feed water at 40 degrees Celsius. Liquid enthalpy is this. Enthalpy of vaporization of water is this. So he's asking you equivalent evaporation. What is equivalent evaporation? So guys, please try to answer. So guys, let me first discuss with you what do you mean by equivalent evaporation. So guys, if you will take water and if you will evaporate it, okay, if you will boil it, suppose under normal condition 100 degrees Celsius, so how much heat it is you are going to supply, okay, divide by the you can say latent heat of vaporization at 100 degrees Celsius, that is known as equivalent evaporation. So how much heat we are supplying in actual case, divide by, if normal evaporation will takes place at 100 degrees Celsius, what will be the heat supplied? That ratio is known as equivalent evaporation. So equivalent evaporation, agar main yahan likhta hun, this is equivalent evaporation kg per hour, equivalent evaporation in kg per hour. So this is nothing but the heat we are supplying divided by HFG at 100 degrees Celsius. HFG at 100 degrees Celsius. So how much heat we are supplying and how much will be the heat supplied if water will be boiled normally at 100 degrees Celsius. So at 100 degrees Celsius, how much heat we need to supply? That is HFG. Okay. So HFG is the heat supplied at 100 degrees Celsius. And this is the heat which we are actually supplying. So this is nothing but mass of the steam produced. Okay. Into H minus H. Okay. H minus HF, you can write. Divide by HFG at 100 degrees Celsius. So how much heat, how much steam we are producing? We are producing 2000 kg of the steam. How much is the enthalpy? It is going out with the enthalpy 2426. The steam is going out with the enthalpy 2426. What is HF? HF is 168. Okay. What is HFG? What is HFG at 100 degrees Celsius, sir? This is HFG, 2258. Okay. 2258, this is HFG, 2258. Okay. So if you will solve this, guys, this will be easily cancel out each other and you will get equivalent evaporation also equal to 2000 kg per hour. Okay. So equivalent evaporation for this question is nothing but same 2000 kg per hour. So you can go with option B. Are you getting the idea, guys? So equivalent evaporation is nothing but how much heat we are supplying, mass of the steam produced into the enthalpy at which steam is going out minus HF. Because you know, in the we are having the liquid generally, okay. So that H enthalpy in the subcooled region and HF of the, you can say enthalpy of the saturated liquid, both are almost same. So this is the enthalpy change, H minus HF, multiplied by mass of the steam. So this is the heat we are supplying, divided by how much heat we need to supply if we will boil the water at 100 degrees Celsius, that is HFG. So this ratio Q by HFG at 100 degrees Celsius, this is known as equivalent evaporation. So for this question, the answer is 2000 kg per hour. Is that clear, guys? Chali, good. So just remember this concept if you will find similar type of question. So next question, guys, in front of you. Reheat factor for a multi-stage steam turbine. Reheat factor for a multi-stage steam turbine. Okay, what is reheat factor for a multi-stage steam turbine? So guys, reheat factor is nothing but it is a cumulative enthalpy drop. Cumulative enthalpy drop. Enthalpy drop divided by enthalpy drop in adiabatic process in single stage. Okay, cumulative enthalpy drop divided by the enthalpy drop in the adiabatic process. Okay, so what will you answer, guys, for this question? The cumulative enthalpy drop to the total adiabatic, reversible adiabatic means isentropic. Reversible adiabatic का मतलब क्या होता है? Isentropic. Okay. So if you write it here, guys, you know, Rankine cycle, if you will draw something like this. So this is your saturation curve. Okay. So suppose this is the superheating, reheating process, something like this. Okay. So suppose this is what? Like, let me expand this up to this. Okay. So let me mark here different points. So this is point one. This is point one. This one. This is point two. Okay. This is suppose 0.3 and this is 0.4, for example. Okay, so here what is H1 minus H2? This is the enthalpy drop in the turbine 1. H3 minus H4, this is the enthalpy drop in the turbine 2. So cumulative enthalpy drop. Enthalpy drop here. Cumulative enthalpy drop divided by enthalpy drop in the isentropic process, means H1 minus H4, single stage mein. Single stage mein, how much will be the enthalpy drop? That is known as reheat factor. And obviously, this reheat factor will be greater than 1. Because then only we are going to get the more power. Okay, so reheat factor is always greater than 1. Okay, it is desired to have more than 1, because if you are expanding the steam in multiple turbines, so that you will be able to get more work output. Okay, so cumulative enthalpy drop in different turbines divided by enthalpy drop in the isentropic expansion process. Okay, so option B is the right answer for this question. Chaliye, next question in front of you. A piston of a vertical piston cylinder device. There is a piston, vertical piston cylinder device containing a gas which is has a mass 60 kg. So there is a piston, okay, piston of mass 60 kg, and the cross sectional area is 0.04 meter cube. The entire system is placed in vacuum chamber. So means here the pressure is zero, P atmospheric is zero. How we can say that? Because this entire arrangement is placed in the vacuum. Okay. If the gas temperature is 70 degrees Celsius, what is the pressure of the gas inside the cylinder? What is the pressure of the gas inside the cylinder, guys? Very simple question, guys. And this was asked in SSC. So you cannot say, sir, can it will be asked to us like in CSL? Yes. Okay. So these some basic concept you need to have. So what you can say here, in equilibrium, internal force equal to external force, yes or no? In equilibrium, internal force equal to the external force. In equilibrium condition, internal force equal to external force. What is internal force, guys? Internal force is internal pressure into area. Internal pressure into area, this is internal force. What is external force, guys? There is no external pressure. The external pressure is zero. So the external pressure force is only mg. Okay. The external force is only mg. Okay. The external force is only mg. Okay, so if you will balance here, write it here. This we want to find out internal pressure. Mass of the piston is 60, g is 9.81, and the area is 0.04. Okay, so from you can easily solve this because roughly you need to solve. Okay, roughly आपको इसको solve करना है, easily you will get the answer. So 60 into 10 divided by 4 into 10 की power minus 2. Okay, 16 to 10 divided by 4 into 10 की power minus 2. So this will cancel out. You will get 15. So 15 into 10 की power minus 3. Okay, so this will go up and you will get 15 into 10 की power 3. Okay, or you can write it as what? You can write it as 0.15 bar. Why? Sir, 10 की power 5 is equal to 1 bar. 10 की power 5 what? Newton per meter square. Okay, because we are using here all SI units. So you will get what? This you will get pressure in what? Bar. Okay, so 15 into 10 की power 3. Newton per meter square or 0.015 bar. So there is no option with 0.15 because we replaced the G with this 10. So you can go with option D. This is very close to 0.15. So 0.17 bar is the answer for this question. Okay, option D is the right answer. Chaliye, definitely you can prepare. You know, there is no negative marking. Good. Chaliye, so let's move to next question, guys. A heat engine is supplied with this much of heat, 278 kilowatt of heat at constant fixed temperature of 283 degrees Celsius. And the heat rejection is taking place at 5 degrees Celsius. The engine is reversible, the heat rejected. How much is the heat rejected? He is asking you. Okay, so both temperatures are given to us. Temperature limits are given to us, heat supplied is given to us, and he has given you the engine is reversible one. So how much is the heat rejected? You know, guys, efficiency of a reversible heat engine is nothing but 1 minus T lower by T higher, or you can write it as T higher minus T lower by T higher. Okay, but you need to use this temperature in what? Degree Kelvin. Okay, if you will use this temperature in degree Celsius, you will get the wrong answer. So what is T higher, guys? T higher here is this 283 degrees Celsius. So if you add this 283 plus 273, let me check what we'll get. 655556. So we will get 556 minus T lower. T lower is what? This is 278. Okay. Divide by 556. Okay. 556 minus 278 divided by 556. And simply you can guess, guys, this is actually twice of this. So in the numerator, you will get 278. In the denominator, you will get a 556, means the efficiency is nothing but 50%. The efficiency is 50%, guys. Okay, the efficiency is 50%. 50% efficiency means the heat which we are supplying, 50% of that we will be able to convert into work, and 50% we need to reject. So out of that, what is the 50% of this, guys? The 50% of this is what? 139. Okay, so 139 is the right answer for this question. So this much is the heat supplied. Out of this, 50% will produce work, 139 kilowatt, and 139 kilowatt we need to reject. Okay. Further, if you want to solve this, if you are interested to solve, you can write it here. Sir, efficiency we calculated 0.5. And sir, efficiency is nothing but W net divided by heat supplied. Okay. So W will be 0.5 into heat supplied 278. So you will get what? 139. Okay. So 139 is the work developed. So what is work? Work is heat supplied minus heat rejected. So heat rejected will be heat supplied minus W. Then also you will get 278 minus 139. Again, you will get 139. So it's up to you, but don't go with this process. If you are preparing for PSUs, at least don't go with this process. Only you need to think efficiency 50% means 50% we are converting into work, 50% we are rejecting. Okay. Chaliye. Yes, you can go with that Q1 by T1 equal to Q2 by T2 also. Very good. You can apply that method also here. Bilkul sahi aapne socha hai. Q1 by T1 that is equal to Q2 by T2. Okay. So from this also you can get the answer. Isse bhi aapke paas bilkul sahi answer aa jayega. Q1 is the heat supplied. Q1 is the heat rejected. T1 is the source temperature. T2 is the sink temperature. From that also you will get the answer. And yes, it is comparatively more shorter. ओके बिल्कुल शॉर्ट में आ जाएगा विनोद. यस, योर अप्रोच इज फाइन. गुड. चलिए, सो नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन गाइस इन फ्रंट ऑफ यू. when wet stream flow through a throttle valve. Wet steam flows through a throttle valve. Its temperature increases, dryness friction improves. Temperature increases, dryness friction decreases. Temperature decreases, dryness friction improves. Temperature and dryness friction both decreases. Please try to answer. मेरे ख्याल से बच्चे अभी I can't say कि कितने क्वेश्चन हुए. मेरे ख्याल से 50% से ज्यादा हो गए होंगे. चलिए गुड. So when wet steam flows through a throttle valve, you know guys, throttling is actually expansion process. Throttling is an expansion process. So when steam is flowing through a throttling device, the pressure is going to decrease. Pressure is going to decrease. Throttling is an expansion process. Okay. So here, if you will take this wet steam, so this is the wet steam which you are having initially, and this is at a pressure something like this. This is at a high pressure. What? Why actually I'm taking this point here? ये point मैं यहाँ क्यों ले रहा हूँ बच्चों? Because this is the wet steam. This is the wet steam. Okay. So wet steam. This is the condition one. You are expanding this steam means its pressure is going to decrease and the process is what isenthalpic. Process क्या होता है? Isenthalpic. Okay. So it is better to draw this on pH diagram also so that you will get more clarity. Okay. So this is pressure versus enthalpy diagram. This is temperature versus entropy diagram. Because we want to observe the enthalpy, so it is better to use this diagram, pressure versus enthalpy diagram. Okay, so this is the condition one, guys. This is the condition one. Okay, the steam is at this pressure, okay, P1. This is the pressure P1. When you are expanding this steam at what constant enthalpy? So this is isenthalpic line. This is 0.1, this is 0.2. This pressure is P2. Because the pressure is going to decrease, that's why this process will be in downward direction. This process will surely be in the downward direction. How we can say the enthalpy is constant, sir? In throttling process, enthalpy is going to remain same and the pressure is going to decrease. And easily you can observe it from here, sir. This is the dryness friction. Okay, these are the dryness friction line. Okay, so here at this line, this particular line, x is 1. Here the x equal to 0. And in this direction, guys, when we are moving, the x is increasing. In this direction, when we are moving, x is increasing. So clearly, you can observe it from here. Sir, here, x will be some value, say 1.1. And here, when we are moving in this direction, so we are moving from 0 to 1, means x is increasing. So dryness friction is going to what? It is going to increase. But when you are carrying out expansion, the temperature is going to decrease. So temperature is going to decrease and dryness friction is going to improve. So you can go with option what? Let us check. Temperature decreases, dryness friction improves. Option C is the right answer for this question. Okay. Option C is the right answer, guys, for this question. Very good. Okay. Is that clear? Yes. So when you are expanding a gas, wet steam through a throttling device, the dryness friction will improve. You can show this on TS diagram also, guys. TS diagram pe bhi show kar sakte ho. This is high pressure line P1. This is low pressure line P2. So when you are decreasing the pressure, the temperature is going to decrease. This is temperature T1. This is temperature T2. So temperature is going to decrease. Entropy is going to increase. Why? Because this is an irreversible process. Okay. Entropy badega, temperature decrease karega. Pressure is also going to decrease. And the dryness friction X is going to increase. Okay. So it is better to show on pH diagram, or you can get idea from TS diagram also. Let's move to next question, guys. Which of the following gas highest value of characteristic gas constant? Which of the following gas has highest value of characteristic gas constant? Very simple question. Very simple, guys. I hope this all will be easily able to answer. Okay, which of the following gas has the highest value of characteristic gas constant? What is characteristic gas constant, guys? This is nothing but universal gas constant divided by molecular weight. Okay, so gas which is having what highest value, with the gas which is having least molecular weight, out of these gases, the gas which is having least molecular weight, that gas will have highest characteristic gas constant. So what is the molecular weight for nitrogen? For nitrogen, the molecular weight is 28. For carbon dioxide, the molecular weight is 44.
For sulfur dioxide, the molecular weight is 64, and for oxygen, the molecular weight is 32. Okay, so out of these gases, which one is having least molecular weight? Nitrogen. So the characteristic gas constant for nitrogen will be highest. Okay, this will be the maximum. So you can go with option A as the right answer. Option A is the right answer. Why? Because universal gas constant is same for all. 8.314 kilojoule per kilomole Kelvin. Okay, so the gas which is having least molecular weight, that gas will have highest characteristic gas constant. Okay, yes, very good. Option A is the right answer for this question. Next question, guys, in front of you. The ratio of air required for complete combustion of carbon dioxide to that carbon monoxide. Okay, carbon dioxide means carbon ko carbon dioxide banana hai aapko, CO2. Okay, aur carbon ko CO banana hai, carbon monoxide. So what is the ratio of what? Air required. Isme kitna air chahiye? Isme kitna air chahiye? What is the ratio? Very simple common sense question, guys. Easily you can answer this. Easily you can answer this question. If I will take carbon, how much oxygen is required for complete combustion of carbon? This is one mole. This is also one mole. Okay. And you are getting one mole of what? CO2. So one mole of carbon required one mole of oxygen, and we will get one mole of CO2. Okay. But you know, guys, N equal to M by M. Number of moles equal to the mass divided by molecular weight. Okay. So how much mass is required? Number of moles multiplied by molecular weight. So what is the molecular weight of carbon? 12. So 12 kg carbon requires 32 kg oxygen. 12 kg carbon requires 32 kg oxygen. Okay, you can write it here. 12 kg carbon requires 32 kg oxygen. Okay, so how much oxygen for 1 kg carbon? 1 kg carbon requires 32 by 12 kg of oxygen. 1 kg carbon requires 32 by 12 kg of oxygen, and 1 kg of carbon require 32 by 12 into 0.23. Why? Because on mass basis, like in air, there is a 23% of the oxygen, okay, and remaining is what? Other gases. So mass fraction, what is the mass fraction of oxygen in air? That is 23%. So 32 divided by 12 into 32, you will get a value close to 11.59. You can check. So for 1 kg of carbon, how much air required? 11.56. 1 kg carbon, how much is air required? 11.5. Or what you can say, what is the air fuel ratio for carbon? Complete combustion of carbon, what is the air fuel ratio? 11.59 ratio 1. That is the air fuel ratio for carbon. Okay. Here, as you can easily check, yahan pe kitna hai? This is 2, this is 1. Okay. So similar way, if you will check here, you will get half of this. Aapke paas kya aayega? Half aayega. And air required for one case, first case, air required for second case, this will be what? This will be just twice. Okay. So the answer for this question will be twice. 2 ho jayega, the answer for this question. Why? Because here we want carbon monoxide. So N in means 12 kg carbon. How much is the oxygen? 16 kg oxygen. Okay. 16 kg oxygen. Because now we don't want CO2. We want carbon monoxide. So 12 kg carbon, 16 kg oxygen. Okay. 1 kg carbon, 16 by 12 kg oxygen. Okay. And 1 kg carbon required 16 by 12 into 0.23. Okay. So if you will check this and this, the only difference is what? Here you are having 32 and here you are having 16. Here you are having 32, here you are having 60. So this will be just half of this. 11.59 divided by 2, just half of this. Okay. So directly, even there is no need to solve, but I discussed with you some related concept so that you will be able to answer what is the air fuel ratio for carbon. Okay. Yes, yes, Joel, your concept is very right. Okay. Directly you need to approach. In objective type question, directly you need to think. Here, first you want carbon dioxide, and for carbon monoxide, that air required will be just half of that. So simply you can answer. But why I discussed all this stuff, guys? So that if you will face some kind of question, what is the air fuel ratio? Stoichiometric air fuel ratio for complete combustion of carbon. So that will be 11.59 ratio 1. How much air is required for the complete combustion of 1 kg of carbon? Sir, 11.59 kg. How much oxygen is required? 32 by 12 kg of the oxygen. For complete combustion of 1 kg of carbon, 32 by 12 kg of oxygen required. This is for oxygen. Okay. This is for oxygen. Oxygen. And this is what? 11.59 kg air. I hope you are getting the concept. Chaliye, let us now move to next question. Very simple direct question, guys, in front of you. What material we use for insulating the body of spark plug? What material we use for insulating the body of spark plug? Okay, so for spark plug we use material made up of alumina. Okay, alumina ka material hum use karte hain for spark plug coating. Okay, you know what is the purpose of spark plug? Spark plug we use in petrol engine to initiate the spark. Okay, in diesel engine we compress the air at a very high pressure so that the air, when you inject the fuel, it will easily able to reach to its ignition temperature, ignition point. But in petrol engine, some kind of initiation is required to initiate the combustion reaction, and that we do with the help of the spark plug. So spark plug body is insulated with some kind of material of made up of alumina. So option A is the right answer for this question. Direct question and directly you need to remember. I'm not going too much detail about this. Ice, if you will kept in a well-insulated thermal flask, ice capped in well-insulated thermal flask is an example of which system? Ice capped in well-insulated thermal flask. Okay. Ice capped in well-insulated thermal flask. Bachcho, pehle hum propylene use karte the. Generally, we want a material which is having very least thermal conductivity. Okay. We want a material which is having very least thermal conductivity. So initially we used propylene also, but nowadays we use material made up of alumina. Okay. So ice capped in well insulated thermal flask is an example of, yes, it is an example of isolated system. There is no heat transfer. There is no work transfer. So the energy is going to remain same. Energy will remain constant. So it is an example of isolated. He mentioned about well insulated. Well insulated means it is an insulated flask. There is no heat transfer. Okay. And in insulated flask, there is no work transfer also. So this is a case of what? Isolated system. No heat transfer, no work transfer, no mass transfer. Okay. Heat transfer, work transfer, mass transfer, all are zero. So energy is going to remain same for this system. So that's why this system is known as isolated system. Next question. Consider the following: temperature, viscosity, internal energy, entropy. Which of the following are extensive property? Out of these four, which of the properties are extensive? Which of the following properties are extensive properties? No, there will be no calculator allowed. Rohit, calculator nahi hoga. Which of the following is extensive? Extensive means independent. Extensive ka matlab kya hota hai? This is dependent. Dependent on size or mass of the system. Dependent on size or mass of system. All energies like kinetic energy, potential energy, internal energy, enthalpy, all are extensive properties. Sabhi kya hoti hai? Extensive. What are intensive? Intensive property are the properties which are independent of the size or mass of the system, like thermal conductivity, viscosity, density, pressure, temperature. Those are intensive property. What are properties? The measurable characteristic of a system which you can measure, those are known as properties. Okay, any measurable characteristic of the system. So properties are of two types: intensive, extensive. Why properties are required? Properties are required to define the state of a system. What is state of a system? The condition of a system at a particular time. What is the condition? Like what mass system is having? Okay. Chaliye. Rohit is saying mock test mein calculator hai. So you can confirm. You can confirm. So guys, out of these, extensive temperature is intensive. viscosity is also intensive, internal energy is extensive, and entropy is also extensive. So 3 and 4, these are the extensive property. So you can go with option D is the right answer. 3 and 4 are the extensive property. 3 and 4 are extensive. 1 and 2 are the intensive property. So for this question, option D is the right answer. The slope of log P versus log V graph for a gas for isothermal change is M1 and for adiabatic change is M2. The gas is diatomic gas. Then what is the relationship between M1 and M2? The slope of log P versus log V graph. The slope of log P versus log V graph for a gas for isothermal change is M1 and adiabatic change is M2. Then what is the relationship between M1 and M2? You know, guys, PV equal to MRT. Okay. PV equal to MRT. You can write it here. Okay. So here, if you want to write PV on PV diagram. So on PV diagram, let me write it here. P equal to MRT by V. Okay. Something like this. I can write. Okay. Yahan se hum isko aisa likh sakte hain. So for a constant temperature process ke liye kya ho jayega? PV equal to constant. Okay. For a constant temperature process, you will have PV equal to constant. So if you will differentiate both sides, you can write it as PdV plus VdP that is equal to zero. Okay. Or you can write it here PdV equal to minus VdP. Okay. PdV equal to VdP. Or this on PV diagram, dP by dV for isothermal process, temperature constant, that is nothing but minus P by V. So the slope of the isothermal curve, on PV diagram is nothing but P by V, minus P by V. Similarly, if you will take an example of PV ki power gamma equal to constant adiabatic process, again, if you will differentiate P into gamma, V ki power gamma minus 1, dV plus V ki power gamma into dP, that is equal to 0. Okay. So you can easily solve this also. P gamma, V ki power gamma minus 1, dV equal to minus V ki power gamma into dP. Okay. So for this also, if you write dP by dV, you will get gamma times minus gamma P by V. You will get minus gamma P by V. Okay. So this is the slope for adiabatic curve on PV diagram. This is the slope for isothermal curve on PV diagram. Okay. And here, if you will write the dP by dV for the adiabatic process, PV ki power gamma equal to constant is gamma times, is equal to gamma times what? The slope of dP by dV of the isothermal process, temperature equal to constant. Why? Because minus P by V is the slope for the isothermal curve on PV diagram. So clearly you can conclude that the adiabatic slope on the PV diagram is gamma times more than the isothermal slope. Okay. So now let's observe this question, guys. What is given? So on log P versus log V diagram, you can solve it for log P versus log V also. Okay. So aap uske liye bhi kar sakte ho. How? Like here, if I will write it something like this, dP by minus P, okay, equal to dV by V. Yes or no? Can you write it something like this, guys? By interchanging these terms, you can write it something like this. Inko interchange karke aap aisa likh sakte ho. dP by dV isothermal, that is equal to minus P by V. Okay. So if you will, again, here if you will integrate both sides, agar aap yahan pe integrate kar de, integrating both sides, you can write minus ln P, okay, that is equal to ln V plus some constant, yes or no? Minus ln P equal to ln V equal to constant. Okay. Similar way, you can carry out here also. Yahan pe bhi kar sakte aap, like here, you can write dP by dV for adiabatic, PV ki power gamma equal to constant, that is equal to gamma times P by V. Gamma times P by V. Okay, minus gamma times P by V. So here again, if you will carry out, you can check here also ln P by ln V. So if you will take here this as what? You can say y-axis, this as x-axis. Again, if you will take the ratio will come out what? Gamma times. Okay. So the slope of adiabatic is gamma times more than the slope of isothermal. Yahan pe aapko kya karna padega? Again, you need to differentiate. Okay. And if you differentiate, you will have d of ln P, d of ln V. Okay. And then if you will take that slope, you will get the idea. Okay. So I'm not going to that part. Here, just by observing this, you can conclude ki, sir, the slope of isothermal is P by V and the slope of adiabatic is gamma times P by V. So we can say ki, this particular answer for this question is what? For this isothermal is M1, for the adiabatic is M2, and we know M2 is greater than M1. Okay, so you can go with what? You can go with option A as the right answer. Okay, because M is what? M is representing the slope. M kya represent kar raha hai? M is representing the slope. Yes, M is also representing the slope. Okay, so if you want, is for ln log P or log V also? So here I have written how to get this log P and log V. Further, similar way, you can write this for adiabatic also, and you can get take their ratio. Okay, so log P, log V, yahan pe aap le lo, and log P, log V, here if you will take, again you will get the ratio gamma. So what you can say, M2, the slope of the adiabatic is gamma times more than M1. So simply, M2 is greater than M1. So you can go with option A as the right answer. Next question, guys, in front of you. The work done during expansion of a gas is independent of pressure. The work done during expansion of a gas is independent of the pressure if the expansion takes place isothermally, adiabatically, in both the above cases, in none of the cases. In which case, the work will be independent of the pressure. In which case work will be independent of the pressure? You know, guys, for closed system, work equal to integration PdV. Closed system work equal to integration PdV. For isothermal, work for isothermal, work equal to P1V1 ln of V1 by V2, ln of V2 by V1. Okay, and for adiabatic, PV ki power gamma equal to constant. For adiabatic, work equal to P1 V1 minus P2 V2 divided by gamma minus 1. This is for adiabatic, this is for isothermal. For constant pressure, work equal to P into V2 minus V1. Okay. So this is for constant pressure, this is for isothermal, this is for adiabatic. And you are not going to find out any case. Why? Because work, closed system work, is equal to integration PdV. So in all the cases, work is required to be dependent on pressure. Okay, so there is no such case in which you will get work independent of pressure. So you can go with option D as the right answer. There is no case in which you will find the work independent of the pressure. So D is the right answer, guys, for this question. D will be the right answer. Work done during expansion of a gas is independent of pressure. In all the cases, whether the process is isothermal, adiabatic, constant pressure, polytropic, any case, work will be dependent on the pressure. So there is no case. You can go with option D as the right answer. Okay. Chaliye, next question, guys, in front of you. Which of the following process are thermodynamically irreversible? Which of the following process are thermodynamically irreversible? What do you mean by irreversible process, guys? A process is known as irreversible if there is some kind of heat dissipation effect, and what you can see, if there is non-equilibrium between system and surrounding. Okay, the irreversibility will be there due to non-equilibrium between system and surrounding. Non-equilibrium between system and surrounding, that causes irreversibility. And further, what you can say? Just a second, chaliye. So gradual heating of water from the hose, that is also an irreversible process. This is also irreversible. Isothermal expansion, Stirling cycle, guys. Stirling cycle, Stirling, Erickson, Carnot. These are your reversible cycle, completely reversible. Stirling, Erickson, your Carnot. Okay. So in isothermal, constant temperature, this process is what? This is reversible one. This is reversible. Mixing of two streams, that is also irreversible. So from this question, 1 and 3 are irreversible. So you can go with option D. 1 and 3 are irreversible. Option D is the right answer for this question. Note C, guys. Option D is the right answer. Isothermal expansion, like the Carnot engine. You know, Carnot engine, when, what you need to understand, guys, when you are adding heat, suppose this is your body. This is body. Okay. At temperature T. This is surrounding at temperature T. Both are at constant temperature. Body, where you are adding heat, this is your surrounding. So, what is the entropy change of surrounding? When you are adding heat Q, what is the entropy change of the surrounding, guys? The entropy change of the surrounding will be minus Q by T, because entropy of the surrounding is going to decrease. you can write it as source actually. So surrounding likhna ya source likhna hai, you can write it something like this. So there is a source at temperature T and there is a body where you are adding heat and that is also at temperature T. So when you are taking heat from the source, so the entropy change of the source will be minus Q by T. It is supplying heat, so its entropy is going to decrease, minus Q by T. You are adding heat into the body, what is the entropy change of the body? That is Q by T. So Q by T both are same. So what is entropy generation? That will be zero. So in a reversible process, guys, when we are adding heat at constant temperature, there will be no entropy generation. In Carnot cycle, you are adding heat at constant temperature, so entropy generation will be zero. In adiabatic process, the adiabatic process is reversible. Reversible adiabatic is isentropic. So entropy change of system is zero. And as the process is adiabatic, there is no heat transfer to the surrounding. So entropy change of surrounding will be zero. So in two adiabatic, reversible adiabatic process, there is no entropy generation. In two constant temperature process, there is no entropy generation. So that's why in isothermal process, that is known as reversible. But what is the condition? No gradients between system and surrounding. No gradients between system and surrounding. Okay. Actually, this is not possible. How you will add heat with the zero temperature difference? Is it possible? No. Like if you want to add heat with zero temperature difference, that process is going to take years to happen. Okay. So the engine will run at a very slow speed. Okay. Even by your own foot, you will be able to move like if you are like having a Carnot engine. So nobody want to sit on a particular engine which is operating on Carnot engine. Why? Because the Carnot engine speed will be very slow. Okay. So there is no such practicality of this engine, Carnot engine, because this is actually a reversible engine, but it is not feasible in practice. Okay. Because this constant temperature heat addition process is a very slow process. Okay. And it is not possible in real practice. Always some kind of temperature difference is required to add the heat. So what do you mean by this? External irreversibility. If there are gradients between system and surrounding, that cause external irreversibility. You know, in a boiler, what I mentioned, guys, when we are carrying out the reheating, if your reheating pressure is very high, means reheating pressure divided by boiler pressure, if that pressure is very high, reheating pressure is high. Okay, so what will happen? The flue gas which you are passing and the steam which you are reheating, if their temperature difference is very less, so irreversibility will be less and efficiency is going to increase. But if you are carrying out reheating at a very low pressure, what will happen? At low pressure, the steam energy will be very less, the steam temperature will be very less, and that steam, if you are reheating with flue gases which are at high temperature, so their irreversibilities will be very high. So if the temperature difference between source and body is high, irreversibility will be more and efficiency, or what you can say, losses will be high and efficiency will be low. Okay, and if there is a temperature difference, very less temperature difference is there between source and the body, or what you can say, the body where you are adding heat, if less is the temperature difference, more will be the efficiency, more will be the available energy, and less will be the irreversibility. That is the reason, guys, we go with first economizer, evaporator, and superheater. In economizer, we preheat the preheat the water by utilizing the waste gases. Why? Because waste gases, they are also at low temperature, and water which is entering into the boiler, that is also at low temperature. So their temperature difference is very low. So irreversibility will be less, efficiency will increase. Evaporation, we carry out in the evaporator, and superheating we carry out by using the fresh flue gases. Why fresh? Because superheating steam, that is at high temperature. Fresh flue gases, they are also at high temperature. So their temperature difference is very low, and efficiency is going to improve. So if you will increase the mean temperature of heat addition, available energy increases, irreversibility decreases, efficiency improves. Okay, so that is a concept of this mean temperature, or what you can say, the temperature difference. If there is no temperature difference, there will be no irreversibility, the process will become reversible. But if there is temperature difference, and in actual case there must be some kind of temperature difference, due to that there will be external irreversibility. Chali, next question. Consider the following statement. Availability is generally conserved. Guys, only energy is conserved. Energy conserved hoti hai. Energy to conserved hota hai. But entropy, available energy, these are not conserved. Entropy is going to increase. Available energy is always going to decrease in a real process. In a real process, there must be generation of entropy. There must be degradation of energy, available energy, quality of energy, potential of work. So work we are going to lose in a real process. Entropy we are going to generate in a real process. Energy is going to remain conserved. This is conserved. Okay. So there is no concept of conservation of availability. This is not going to conserve. This is even we are going to degrade. We are going to lose some kind of available energy. Okay. So this is not right. Availability can either be negative or positive. Availability, kya hoga? It will always be positive. This is also not right. Okay, we can like suppose if you are having a system lower than that, it can be negative also. But in actual case, like what we want availability positive so that we will be able to draw some work. So it may be the case. Availability can be positive, negative, ho sakta hai. Availability is the maximum theoretical work obtainable. This is also right. Availability represents the maximum work which we can obtain. Okay. Availability can be destroyed in irreversibility. Yes, this is also right. So if there is some option with the 2, 3, 4, we can go with that. 2, 3, 4, but there is no option. So it is better to go with 3 and 4. Okay. 3 and 4. Why? Because availability, we are interested in positive availability. Okay. We are interested in positive availability. But if you are having some system which are having at a condition lower than the atmospheric condition, are you getting the idea? So these are the atmospheric conditions. Suppose 27 degrees Celsius atmospheric pressure. And suppose your system is at minus 50 and some pressure lower than that. So availability can be negative also. Are you getting? In that case, actually, work will be obtained from atmospheric condition to that. Are you getting? So we can represent. In books, you will find availability negative also. Okay, so there is concept. But generally, we want availability positive. So there is no option with 2, 3, 4. So it is better to go with option A, 3 and 4. Okay. Is that clear, guys? चलिए next question in front of you. During a thermodynamic process, 100 kilojoule of heat is transferred from a reservoir at 800 Kelvin and sink at 400 Kelvin. The ambient temperature is this. What is the loss in available energy? What is the loss in available energy? Very simple question in front of you. So there is a thermodynamic process, 100 kilojoule of heat you are transmitting. So guys, here, let me tell you the basic concept first. Here, if you want to find out the available energy 1, that is equal to Q into 1 minus TO by T1, yes or no? So what is Q? Q is 100. 1 minus what is TO? This is 300. What is high temperature? This is 800. So available energy will be 100 into 500 divided by 800. Okay, so it will be 500 divided by 8. This is the available energy in first case. This is the available energy in first case. Similarly, what is available energy in second case? So this is Q into 1 minus TO by T2. Now the heat is at low temperature. Okay. So how much is the Q? This is 100 into 1 minus, this is 300 divided by 400. Okay. So this will be what? This will be 100 into, let me check the data. Yes. Okay. So this will be 100 divided by 400. So this will be simply 1 by 4th of this means 25. This will be 25 kilojoule. Okay. So here the available energy in second case is 25 kilojoule. And the available energy in the first case is what? Isko karoge to it will be 6, then 2, then 5. So you will get 62.5 kilojoule. So in first case, the available energy is 62.5 kilojoule. Second case, the available energy is 25 kilojoule. Means how much available energy we are losing? Loss in available energy. This is also known as irreversibility. So this is nothing but AE1, available energy in first case, minus available energy in the second case. I'm telling you the basic concept. So this will be 62.5 minus 25. So you will get the answer. So 25 plus 12.5. you will get 37.5 kilojoule. So this much is the amount of available energy we are losing. 37.5 is the amount of available energy we are losing in this case. Okay, so you can go with option C as the right answer. Option C as the right answer. Okay, if you want direct formula, guys, you can go into the theory. So loss in available energy is equal to Q into 1 by what? Yahan pe likhoge aap T2 minus, yahan pe kya ho jayega aapka, 1 by T1. Q into 1 by T2 minus 1 by T1. Okay, from this also you can find out the loss in available energy. Okay, Q into 1 by T2 minus 1 by T1, isse bhi aap available energy nikal sakte ho, to 100 into 1 by, this is 400 minus 1 by 800. So you can try to find out something from this. So LCM will be 800, so this will be 2 minus 1. Okay, so it will be 1 by this. try to find out from this also loss in available energy. Okay, yahan pe TO bhi likhna padega. We need to multiply by the TO also, hai na? So DO will be 300. Okay, so TO will be 300. Okay, so yahan pe this is TO into Q into 1 by T2 minus 1 by T1. Okay, so this direct formula also you can use. It depends on you. Then also you will get the answer. So 100 into 300 divided by 800. So it will be what? This will be 300 divided by 8. Okay, so you can check your answer. So from this also you will get the answer 37.5. So it depends on you. You want to use this direct formula TO into Q into 1 by T2 minus 1 by T1, or you can go with this process. What is the available energy initial? What is the available energy in final case? What is the difference? Available energy 1 minus 2, how much we are losing? So from this also, you will get the same answer. 300 by 8, you will get 37.5 right answer. Okay, I hope this is clear to you. Loss, why we lose available energy, guys? Available energy we lose is due to the irreversibility in the system. Due to irreversibility in the system, we lose some amount of available energy. Okay. So if heat is at high temperature, its available energy will be more. If heat is at low temperature, its available energy will be less. So guys, if I will give you 10,000 joules of heat at room temperature, what will be its available energy? Zero. Because entire heat is available at room temperature. Are you getting the room in which I am sitting or room in which you are sitting? There is lots of heat is there in that room, in that you can say surrounding, but that entire heat is at room temperature. So available energy or work associated with that heat is negligible, zero. So if temperature of heat is more, the available energy will be more. Okay, next question, guys, in front of you. In the bottoming of cogeneration low grade waste heat is used. Guys, you know, there are cogeneration plant. In cogeneration plant, the steam produced in the boiler is used for power generation also and for process heating also. You know, in some kind of industry like textile mills, sugar mills, we require lots of amount of steam. Okay, so in those plants, we go with this cogeneration plant. What is a cogeneration plant? In cogeneration plant, we produce steam into the boiler. Then we use that steam for two purposes. First is the power generation and second is the process heating. Okay, if we are using the high pressure steam produced in the boiler for power generation, that is known as topping cycle. Usse hum bolte hain topping cycle. Topping cycle kya ho jayega? Topping means in topping cycle, the high pressure steam which we are producing, first we are using it for power generation, and the steam which is coming out from the turbine, that we are using for process heating. That is known as topping cycle. Easily from the name itself you will get the idea. Topping means high pressure steam we are using for power generation, low pressure steam which is coming out from the turbine, that we are using for process heating. In bottoming cycle mein kya karenge hum? In bottoming cycle, the steam which we are producing, okay, topping cycle mein we are producing the power. In bottoming cycle mein kya hoga? The first we are using the steam, okay, for the process heating, and the low pressure steam we are using for the power generation. Okay, so in bottoming cycle of cogeneration, low grade waste heat is used. Low grade waste heat ko hum kahan pe use karenge? Topping cycle mein hum use karte hain power generation ke liye. Waste heat ko hum use karte hain for process heating, and here in bottoming cycle, low grade waste heat. Abhi yahan pe kya hai hamare paas? Low grade. Okay, bottoming cycle mein hum क्या कर रहे हैं? The power, the high pressure steam we are using for process heating, low power we will use for power generation. So I think option D will be the right answer. Option B will be the right answer for this. Okay, so please check it again. If you are having any confusion, topping cycle, bottoming cycle, there are two type of regeneration plant. Regeneration plant, we are using it for steam generation as well as process heating. Okay, power generation, process heating. So steam which you are producing at high pressure, suppose first you are utilizing it for power generation. So that is a topping cycle. First we are producing power out of that, and then waste heat we are using for process heating. Okay. In bottoming cycle, first we are what? You are using it as a, you can say process heating, and then the waste heat we are using for the power generation. So for bottoming cycle, he's asking you about the bottoming cycle. So what will happen? Power generation. Waste heat we will use for power generation. So B is the right answer. Consider the following emission of IC engine: carbon monoxide, hydrocarbon, NOx, and particulate matter. Which of the following caused photochemical smoke? Which of the following caused photochemical smoke, guys? Try to answer. Which of the following we use for photochemical smoke? Yes. Chaliye. So guys, you know, this hydrocarbon and NOx, these causes the photochemical smoke. Majorly, the photochemical smoke is due to the NOx formation. So both NOx and hydrocarbon emission, they cause photochemical smoke. So 2 and 3 is the right answer. You know guys, NOx formation is there due to high temperature inside the engine. NOx formation will be more in case of diesel engine. Hydrocarbon emission, or what you can say, sorry, carbon monoxide emission, because incomplete combustion will be there in case of petrol engine. So carbon emission will be more in case of petrol engine. NOx emission will be more in case of diesel engine. Okay. Generally, NOx, you can say photochemical smoke results due to formation of hydrocarbon and NOx. Okay. NOx and these, they actually, they combine. Okay. In the atmosphere, and they form that kind of, what you can say, layer in the atmosphere. Okay. That layer is known as photochemical smoke. Okay. So visibility bahut kam ho jata hai, and that is very much dangerous for us. Okay. Kuch areas mein, like if you will check, due to very high pollution, due to very high NOx emission and hydrocarbon emission, some layer develop. Okay, that decreases, that brown color layer forms, that decreases our visibility also, and that is very dangerous for us, human body. Okay, so 2 and 3, hydrocarbon and NOx, they form the photochemical smoke. Next question in front of you. There is a hemispherical sphere, surface one. So this is surface one, guys, hemisphere. This is flat plate, surface two, such that convex portion of the hemisphere is facing sky. Convex portion is facing sky. What is the value of geometric shape factor F12? Is asking you, what is F12? How much is the fraction of radiation which are leaving from surface one that are reaching to surface two? How much is the fraction of radiation which are leaving from surface one that are reaching to surface two? What is F12? So how you can answer this question, guys? You know, F11 plus F12, that will be equal to 1. Similarly, you can write F21 plus F22, that is equal to 1. Yes, sir. F22 is a flat surface. So for flat surface, the self shape factor will be 0. So we can say F21 equal to 1. Yes or no? F21 equal to 1. Further, we can write the reciprocity rule between 1 and 2. What is that? Sir, A1 F12 equal to A2 F21. Okay. So if you want to find out F12, so F12 is nothing but A2 by A1 into F21. What is F21? F21 is 1 because F21 is 1 because F22 is 0. So you can write F12 is A2 by A1. Okay. F12 equal to A2 by A1. Okay. So you can check it here. What is A2, guys? What is the surface area? This is ka? It is actually a circle. So the surface area will be pi by 4 d square. This is actually a hemisphere. What is a hemisphere or surface area? For the complete circle, the surface area will be 4 pi r square. So it will be 2 pi r square. 2 pi r square, or you can write it as 2 pi d by 2 square. Okay. Something like this. So this is A2, this is A2 for the flat surface, pi by 4 d square. This is 2 pi r square for the hemisphere. Okay. So if you solve this, F12 equal to pi by 4 d square divided by 2 pi d square by 4. Okay. So simply this pi will cancel out. D square will cancel out. Okay. And this 4 will also be cancel out. You will get 1 by 2 as the right answer. So the friction shape factor is F12 equal to 1 by 2 means option B is the right answer for this question. Please check and you can confirm, is it clear to you guys? Please check the answer. The shape factor or the view factor for this question is F12. Okay, guys, is that clear? Please confirm. This question is clear. So shape factor or view factor for this case is 1/2 means 0.5. Next question in front of you. The liquid phase of a pure substance is termed as dash if the temperature is lower than T saturation. The temperature is lower than T saturation. What you will say? That liquid is superheated liquid, subcooled liquid, metastable liquid, or flashing liquid. What you will say? Very simple, direct question. This is your critical point. This is your saturated liquid line. This is your saturated vapor line. Okay. So if you are having the temperature, this is the temperature. Suppose this is temperature line. This is entropy. Okay. So this is the T saturation. This is your constant pressure line, something like this. Okay. So this is T saturation. This is T saturation. Okay. Suppose if this is a 0.1, okay, and this is the 0.2. This is 0.2. So what you need to understand, guys, if temperature T1 is less than T saturation, if it is less than T saturation, then you will have subcooled liquid. If the temperature is more than T saturation, you can observe it here from guys. This is point T2. So T2 is more than T saturation. We can say this is superheated vapor. So if the temperature is less than T saturation, you will have subcooled liquid, compressed liquid, both are same. Subcooled, compressed. Temperature less than T saturation. Temperature more than T saturation, superheated vapor. Temperature equal to T saturation. Suppose this is 0.3, something like this. Temperature equal to T saturation. Then what you will have? You will have a mixture of saturated liquid and vapor. Mixture of saturated liquid and vapor. Okay. So if it is given to you that temperature of a particular mixture is equal to the T saturation, means you are having a mixture. If the temperature is less than T saturation, you are having subcooled liquid. If the temperature is more than T saturation, you are having superheated vapor. So let us check this particular case. So in this case, what is given to us? If the liquid phase of a pure substance is termed as liquid phase, ko kya term karoge aap? If its temperature is lower than saturation temperature, means it is a subcooled liquid. Option B is the right answer for this question. Subcooled liquid. Okay, if the temperature is more than T saturation, undercooled, subcooled, compressed, both are same. This is also known as compressed liquid. Okay. And if the temperature is more than T saturation, you can go with superheated vapor. Liquid likha hai, but you can go with superheated liquid also. If it is here, you will change the question and you will write temperature more than T saturation. Okay, chaliye. Next question, guys, in front of you. For a real gas passing through an insulated throttle valve, real gas you are passing through an insulated throttle valve, the outlet temperature of the gas will be, what will be the outlet temperature, guys? Gas you are passing through an insulated throttle valve. Insulated throttle valve means heat transfer zero, work transfer zero, change in kinetic energy neglected, change in potential energy neglected. So for a throttling process, enthalpy H1 equal to H2. The throttling process is known as an isenthalpic process. Using steady flow energy equation, we can conclude this. So throttling is a steady flow device. Heat transfer zero, work transfer zero, kinetic energy zero, potential energy zero. So then you can answer, you can say, okay, sir, enthalpy at the entry equal to enthalpy at the exit. For a gas, real gas, not for ideal gas. For ideal gas, because ideal gas enthalpy is a function of temperature only, that's why temperature will remain constant. For real gas, ideal gas temperature will remain constant if you are carrying out throttling of a ideal gas. But for real gas, temperature can increase or decrease. टेम्परेचर बढ़ भी सकता है, T2 इज मोर देन T1 इफ म्यू जे टी इज नेगेटिव, म्यू जे टी नेगेटिव है, ओके, एंड टेम्परेचर कैन डिक्रीज ऑल्सो इफ म्यू जे टी इज पॉजिटिव. दिस इज नोन एज जूल थॉम्सन कोफिशियंट. ओके, सो दिस इज नोन एज हीटिंग प्रोसेस, हीटिंग, ओके, एंड दिस इज नोन एज कूलिंग प्रोसेस. Okay, so mu jt positive, you will get decrease in temperature. Mu jt negative, you will get increase in temperature. So for real gas, temperature can increase, temperature can decrease. Okay, you cannot say that temperature is going to decrease or increase. It depends on the Joule-Thomson coefficient. What is this Joule-Thomson coefficient, guys? This is the slope of the del T by del P isenthalpic curve on temperature versus pressure diagram. The slope of isenthalpic curve on temperature versus pressure diagram. Okay. So here, if you will draw something like this, if you will take it here, this is temperature axis, this is pressure axis. If you will draw here isenthalpic curve, so this is suppose some isenthalpic curve, H equal to constant, H1 equal to constant. Okay, this is first isenthalpic curve, this is second isenthalpic curve, this is third isenthalpic curve. And how you will have so many isenthalpic curve, guys? इतनी एथैल्पी कर्व कहां से मिलेगी आपको? सो फर्स्ट आइसेंथैल्पी कर्व यू आर गोइंग, यू आर गेटिंग, सपोज इनलेट कंडीशन यू मेंटेन सम इनलेट कंडीशन, सो एट सम टेंपरेचर प्रेशर द एयर इज दैट पर्टिकुलर गैस इज एंटरिंग. सो एट ए पर्टिकुलर टेंपरेचर प्रेशर व्हेन गैस इज एंटरिंग, इट इज एंटरिंग विद सम एंथैल्पी, सो दैट एंथैल्पी इज गोइंग टू रिमेन कांस्टेंट इन द थ्रॉटलिंग प्रोसेस. सो प्रेशर इज गोइंग टू डिक्रीज, दैट्स व्हाई इन दिस एरिया, इन दिस डायग्राम, इफ यू वांट टू ऑब्जर्व, यू नीड टू लुक इन दिस डायरेक्शन, बिकॉज प्रेशर इज गोइंग टू डिक्रीज. प्रेशर क्या करना है? डिक्रीज करना है. ओके, pressure is going to decrease in a throttling process. So you need to observe in this direction. Why we will have so many isenthalpic curve, guys? By changing the inlet condition. So if you will change the inlet condition, temperature, pressure, the enthalpy of the incoming air will change. So you will have another isenthalpic curve, another isenthalpic curve. So the slope of this curve on T versus P diagram, this is known as mu jt. Okay. The slope of this curve on T versus P diagram, that is known as mu jt, Joule-Thomson coefficient. But for this examination, only you need to know mu jt positive, you will get cooling, mu jt negative, you will get heating. Okay. So for this question, the right answer is option C. It may increase, it may lower, or it can remain constant. It depends on the Joule-Thomson coefficient of that gas. चलिए मैं बताता हूं आपको, एक बच्चा पूछ रहा है तो मैं बता देता हूं आपको inversion curve क्या होती है. Okay. Let me tell you, guys, like suppose throttling device, this is your throttling device. Suppose this is your throttling device. Okay. This is your throttling device. This is the inlet condition one. This is the inlet condition two. Suppose you maintained some inlet condition T1, P1. Okay. These are the inlet condition you maintained initially. Okay. These are the inlet condition which you maintained initially. So at this condition, you will have some enthalpy H1, yes or no? At this condition, you will have some enthalpy H1. So you will, if you will draw here, temperature versus pressure diagram, you will get a curve something like this. Okay, you will get a curve something like this. This is the curve which is H1 for a constant enthalpy H1. Similarly, by changing the inlet condition, by if you will change this temperature pressure, the enthalpy of the incoming air will change. So you will have another isenthalpic curve. Similarly, you can have so many isenthalpic curves, something like this. Okay, so this is enthalpic H1, this is H2, H3 and H4. So you will have different isenthalpic curve. Okay. So the point where the slope is becoming zero, that point is known as inversion point. Okay. So the point where the slope is zero, that point is known as inversion point. Okay. Something like this. The point where the slope is zero, that point is known as inversion point. Something like this. So this is the inversion point. This is the inversion point. Okay, and if you will join all these inversion point, you will have a inversion curve. So this is known as inversion curve. Inversion curve. Okay, so the locus of the all inversion point, that is known as inversion curve. Locus of all inversion point, that is known as inversion curve. Okay, and the point where this inversion curve will cuts the temperature axis, this is known as maximum inversion temperature. This particular temperature, this is known as temperature, maximum inversion temperature, guys. Maximum inversion temperature. The point where inversion curve is cutting the temperature axis, that is known as maximum inversion temperature. So overall, guys, whether you are going to get cooling or heating, that depends on this maximum inversion temperature. Okay. So if this maximum inversion temperature is very high as compared to T atmospheric. If this maximum inversion temperature is very high as compared to T atmospheric. So what you will have, guys? What you will have at atmospheric condition, if you are carrying out the throttling, in which region you are? You are here. You are in this region. How you can say, sir, the gas which we are throttling, for that gas, the maximum inversion temperature is very high. So at atmospheric condition, we will be in this particular region. Okay. So if you will decrease the pressure, where you will move? You will move in this left direction only. So temperature will always decrease. So for the gases, if the inversion temperature is very high, so you will get the cooling effect. Like for CO2, oxygen, their inversion temperature is very high. But for some of the gases like hydrogen, helium, their inversion temperature is very low. So this inversion temperature, if it is low, lower than atmospheric, T maximum inversion, okay, if it is what? Lower than T atmospheric. So if it is lower than T atmospheric, means at atmospheric condition, in which region you will lie? You will lie in the this region, left of this region. Are you getting? You will lie right of the inversion curve. So if you are left of the inversion curve, you will get the cooling. If you are right of the inversion curve, you will get the heating. Why? Because inversion temperature is very low. So at atmospheric conditions, if you will throttle a gas like hydrogen, helium, because their inversion temperature, maximum inversion temperature is very low, so you will get the heating effect. Why? Because their mu jet is negative in the atmospheric conditions. So if you want to throttle those gases, what you need to do? First, you need to pre-cool those gases. Aapko unko pre-cool karna padega below the atmospheric temperature. Okay, first you need to reach the temperature of those gases below their inversion temperature. Okay, so first if you will pre-cool those gas and then if you will throttle, then you can get cooling effect also. Are you getting? But for throttling of what? Hydrogen, helium, first you need to pre-cool those gases because their inversion temperature is very low. I hope it is now clear. Very quickly I discussed these things. Okay, otherwise, you know, these are going to take much time. Okay, so I cannot go into much more detail. Hope you can understand this thing. Actually, so next question in front of you. For a polytropic process, PV ki power n equal to constant, if n equal to 0. If n equal to 0, the process is called as. You know, guys, there are various processes you can show on PV diagram, pressure versus volume diagram. So this is constant pressure. Okay. This is something like isothermal. This is adiabatic. This is what? Polytropic. So I'm using a expansion chart. Okay, expansion diagram. So this is point. So suppose this is pressure constant. Upper one, pressure constant. This one is what? PV equal to constant. Constant temperature constant. Second one, PV ki power n equal to constant. And last one, PV ki power gamma equal to constant. Adiabatic. Last one is adiabatic. Adiabatic slope is maximum. Second one is polytropic. Middle one. Upper one is isothermal and the top one is what? Constant pressure. Okay. So for constant pressure, the polytropic index n equal to what? 0. Okay. N equal to 0 for constant pressure line. N equal to infinite for constant volume. For constant volume, n equal to infinite. So here n is infinite, here n is 0. Okay. And in this direction, your n is increasing. Okay. So for isothermal ke liye n kya ho jayega? This is 1. For polytropic, n is greater than 1, less than gamma. For adiabatic, n equal to gamma. Means it may be 1.4 or it may be other value depending on that. Okay. So n equal to gamma. So n is increasing in this direction. Constant pressure, n 0. Constant volume, n infinite. Isothermal, n 1. Polytropic, n greater than 1, less than gamma. And for this adiabatic, n equal to gamma. Okay. So in this question, he is asking you, for which process you will have n equal to 0? So n equal to 0 for what? Isobaric, option A. Isochoric, n equal to infinite. Isothermal, n equal to 1. Isentropic, n equal to gamma. Okay, is that clear, guys? I hope this is clear to all. Note isochoric, n equal to 0, guys. N equal to 0. This is 0. Please check, Rohit, please check your answer. Isobaric n equal to 0. Isochoric n equal to infinite. Don't make these kind of mistakes. Chaliye, next question in front of you. Very good question. Simple question hai, but very good one. A Carnot engine implemented using an ideal gas in a piston cylinder arrangement. A Carnot engine implemented using an ideal gas in a piston cylinder system will have. work transfer in two processes of the cycle and heat transfer in the other two processes of the cycle. Work transfer in all four processes and heat transfer in two parts of the cycle. Work transfer in two parts of the cycle, heat transfer in all four parts of the cycle. Work transfer in all four processes of the cycle and heat transfer is also in the all four processes of the cycle. What you will answer? Very simple, common sense question. I think, let me check your response. How many of you are answering this question? Okay, so in Carnot cycle, guys, you know, two processes are isothermal, two processes are adiabatic. So these two processes are isothermal, temperature constant. Okay, these two processes are isothermal. Let me check. Maine sahi bhi draw kiya hai, galat marking kar di hai. So let me correct the marking here. Okay, so let me correct the marking here. So this is 1 to 2 constant temperature. Okay, let me write it here. Something like this. This is isentropic, something like this. Okay, so 1, 2, 2 to 3, 4. Okay, something like this. So I'm changing the marking. So 1 to 2 isothermal rejection, entropy is going to decrease. 3 to 4 is also isothermal heat addition. 2 to 3 is isentropic compression. 4 to 1 is again isentropic expansion. Okay, so this is 1 to 2 isothermal. This is isothermal, and these two are PV ki power gamma equal to constant. Okay, PV ki power gamma equal to constant. वैसे प्रदीप कमाल की बात है, अपने से एक बंदा वो ब्लॉक नहीं हो रहा है, सो गाइस इन कार्नोट साइकिल यू कैन ऑब्जर्व हियर टू प्रोसेसेस आर एडियाबेटिक सो इन टू प्रोसेसेस देयर इज नो हीट ट्रांसफर लाइक इन दिस प्रोसेस 2 to 3 एंड 4 to 1, 1 to 4, 4 to 1, there is no heat transfer. So heat transfer is there in only two processes, not in all four processes. Are you getting the idea? In Carnot cycle, two processes are what? Two processes are adiabatic. So in those two processes, there is no heat transfer. But work transfer is there in all the processes. How you can say that? Sir, this is what? Here, the boundaries are changing or not? In 1 to 2, the boundaries are changing. Yes. So there is work transfer. Here, 2 to 3 also, there is work. 3 to 4 also there is work, 4 to 1 there is also work. Okay, so if you project the area, work will be zero in a closed system only if the process is constant volume. So constant volume work is zero. Okay, so here 1 to 2 also there is work transfer, 2 to 3 there is work transfer, 3 to 4 there is work transfer, and 4 to 1 there is work transfer. What is the difference? 1 to 2 is what? That is negative work. Okay, this is negative work. And these are also what? This is also negative work. So 1 to 2, 2 to 3, these are negative work. 3 to 4, 4 to 1, these are positive work. How you can say that? Sir, during 3 to 4, boundaries are expanding. Volume is increasing, we will get positive work. 4 to 1, boundaries are expanding, we will get positive work. 1 to 2, 2 to 3, these are negative work. But work is there. Work is there in all four processes. Heat transfer is there in only two processes. So you can answer this question something like this. Work transfer, not in two, work transfer in all four, heat transfer in two processes. So option B is the right answer, guys. For this question, option B is the right answer. Very simple question. And only one student answered this question. Vinod, your answer is right. So B is the right answer for this question. Work transfer in all the processes, heat transfer is there in only two processes. Why? Because remaining two processes are adiabatic, reversible adiabatic. And in reversible adiabatic process, there will be no heat transfer. कुछ ही क्वेश्चन बचे हैं बच्चों, दिस इज द लास्ट क्वेश्चन फॉर द टुडे सेशन. लास्ट क्वेश्चन है, दिस इज क्वेश्चन नंबर 40. ओके, सो गाइस लास्ट क्वेश्चन इन फ्रंट ऑफ यू, प्लीज ट्राई टू आंसर दिस आल्सो. क्वेश्चन नंबर 40. नाउ मोस्ट एयर अंडरगोज एन एडियाबेटिक सैचुरेशन प्रोसेस सच दैट द रिलेटिव ह्यूमिडिटी विल व्हाट? इट इज गोइंग टू इंक्रीज, डिक्रीज, और व्हाट? एडियाबेटिक सैचुरेशन प्रोसेस. So if you pass the air over or some in some kind of adiabatic saturator, or what you can say, evaporative cooler. So adiabatic saturator is nothing but your evaporative cooler. Okay. So in that evaporative cooler, what will happen? The humidity increases. The humidity increases and temperature decreases. So this is point one, this is point two. So W2 is more than W1 and DBT, dry bulb temperature 2, that is less than dry bulb temperature 1. Okay. So in case of adiabatic saturation, okay, adiabatic saturation, when we'll pass air over some adiabatic saturator, what will happen? The temperature decreases, humidity increases. So what you can say? And relative humidity also, guys, when you are moving in this direction, you can observe it from here. These are the relative humidity lines. So here, the relative humidity is 100%. Okay. So when you are moving from 1 to 2, the relative humidity is also increasing. So what you can answer? Dry bulb temperature increases, dry bulb temperature decreases, specific humidity is asking you specific humidity. Okay. So that is also increasing. So option C is the right answer for this question. Okay. Humidity is increasing. Okay, and your dry bulb temperature is decreasing. So option C is the right answer. Okay, so let me show here some important processes on the cyclometric chart so that you will be able to recall them. Okay, so let me show here. So guys, this is this process, point 1 to 2. Point 1 to 2, this is known as sensible heating. Point 1 to 2, this is known as sensible heating. 1 to 2, sensible heating. How you can see that? So DPT is increasing, W constant, W1 equal to W2 and temperature is increasing. Temperature increase kar raha hai, humidity ratio is same. So this is sensible heating, 1 to 2. Similarly, what is 2 to 1? 2 to 1 is sensible cooling. There is no need to show that. You can draw and you can remember. 1 to 2, sensible heating, temperature increasing, humidity same. 2 to 1, sensible cooling. Okay. This process, guys, this process, something like this. 2 to 3 is what? It is a humidification process. 2 to 3, humidification. W3 is greater than W2. Humidification. Temperature constant. This is pure humidification. Pure humidification. This is what? 2 to 4. This is dehumidification. 2 to 4, dehumidification. Dehumidification. Okay, and this process, guys, which we have shown here, something like this, humne jo show kiya tha, adiabatic saturation. This actually takes place at constant WBT. So that's why I'm drawing it like a straight line. Okay, WBT is going to remain same. In adiabatic saturation process, your WBT remains constant. Okay, almost WBT will remain constant. So this point 2 to 5, okay, this is what? This is adiabatic saturation process. Humidity increasing, DBT decreasing. Okay. Humidity increasing, DPT also decreasing. Okay, so you will have what? Cooling and humidification. Okay, ek aur process aap ispe show kar sakte ho, which is chemical dehumidification. Chemical dehumidification. So where you can show chemical dehumidification, guys? In chemical dehumidification, the humidity is going to decrease and your temperature is going to increase. So you will have something like this. So I'm showing here. So suppose this is 6. So 2 to 6. 2 to 6 is what? Chemical dehumidification. 2 to 6 is chemical dehumidification. Like when you will pass air over some kind of desiccant, like silica gel. So silica gel is a very good desiccant. It absorbs the water present in the air. So if you will pass air over some kind of desiccant, silica gel, it absorbs the water vapor present in the air. But when it is absorbing that water vapor, what will happen? The water vapor which is there and it is having some latent heat, so it is going to emit that latent heat. So that air will take that latent heat with it. Okay, the latent heat which that water vapor is emitting. So water vapor is converting into liquid, so it is going to reject, it is going to emit what? The latent heat of vaporization. So air will take that latent heat, so its temperature will increase. You can observe T6 is more than T2, temperature is going to increase and humidity is going to decrease. So this is what? 2 to 6 is chemical dehumidification. Chemical dehumidification. For adiabatic saturation, evaporative cooling, the diagram will be same. This is for adiabatic or what? Cooled water. So if you are spraying cooled water, you will have this line. If you will spray hot water, guys, if you will spray hot water, you will have a curve something like this, 2 to 7. So 2 to 7 is what? Humidification with steam. 2 to 7 humidification with steam, 2 to 5 humidification with cold water. There's a difference. This is humidification with cold water, this is humidification with steam. Okay, this is pure humidification is actually not possible. This is very difficult to achieve pure humidification. Humidification, if you want to carry out, you can spray cold water or steam. So if you are spraying cold water, you will get decreasing temperature and humidification. If you will spray hot water or steam, you will get temperature increases, humidification increases. So this is humidification and temperature increases, steam humidification, this is cold water humidification, okay, or evaporative cooling or adiabatic saturation. This is humidification, pure humidification. This is pure dehumidification. This is sensible heating, sensible cooling. This is your chemical dehumidification. So I discussed some of the you can say important processes on this cyclometric chart. I hope this is clear to you. So guys, these are the 40 questions for the today's session we have discussed. Now if you're having any 1-2 specific query, you can discuss with me. Okay, any 1-2 specific query I can take from you, otherwise I'm going to end this session. Okay, yes, please confirm if you are having any query or you want to ask something. And yes, now there is, let me say sorry to you for today's session. Like in the start, I can understand you face some kind of difficulty, but next time surely we will fix all those things. Okay, we will fix the those quality issue also, so that you will get the more clarity of the video. Okay, so surely we are going to fix all those things. Okay, chaliye. Yes, this 1 to 7. 1 to 7. No. 1 to 7 is like, this is 1, this is 7. How, which process you are taking? This 2 to 5 is WBT constant. Adiabatic saturation, we know the adiabatic saturation, humidity remains constant. Okay, adiabatic saturation mein humidity kya rahegi? Constant rahegi. Okay, so guys, thank you very much. Surely you will get information through your PDI YouTube channel, like when will be the next session. Okay, so best of luck and go with full of energy, confidence in this particular examination, as there is no negative marking. So just revise all those things, all those basic stuffs. Okay, and practice more and more. Try to practice more and more questions. Again, we will meet. Thank you very much. Have a nice day. Good luck. 2 to 5 is, yes, 2 to 5 is humidification with cold water. Let me repeat once again with Rohit so that you will get the information. 1 to 6, sensible heating. 6 to 1, sensible cooling. Sensible heating, sensible cooling. 2 to 3, humidification, pure humidification. 2 to 3. 2 to 4, pure dehumidification. Pure dehumidification. 2 to 5, adiabatic saturation. WBT will remain constant, adiabatic saturation. Okay, evaporative cooling also, something like that. But evaporative cooling mein enthalpy change ho jayega. But curve, something like that only I'm representing, because I don't want to mix all those things. Adiabatic saturation, WBT will remain constant and enthalpy will also remain almost constant. Enthalpy bhi almost kya rahega? Constant rahega. How you can say, sir, WBT, this humidity is increasing, but temperature is decreasing. Air temperature is decreasing, humidity is increasing. So almost enthalpy will remain constant in adiabatic saturation process. Okay, but something like that, evaporative cooling mein, WBT is not going to remain constant, but what you can say, the temperature is going to decrease, humidity is going to increase. And same with humidification with cold water. 2 to 7, humidification with hot water or steam. Okay, I think now, and this last one, 2 to 6 is chemical dehumidification. Okay, chemical dehumidification process. Okay, chaliye. Thank you very much. Have a nice day. Keep preparing. Good luck.